Good morning and welcome to the 27th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies for the meeting. The second item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The next item on our agenda is a concluding evidence session as part of our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And I welcome to the committee Eddie Follin, Chief Officer, Health and Social Care, Councillor Paul Kelly, Spokesperson for Health and Social Care, both from COSLA, and we are expecting Louise Long, Chief Executive of Inverclyde Council, Society of Local Authority Chief Executives and Senior Managers at Solace Scotland. And we'll move straight to questions. And Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to both of you. I'm interested to hear if you are still in support of a National Care Service.
Morning, Committee. It's good to be here. Well, the position that COSLA leaders have taken at their most recent meeting is that we've withdrawn from the shared accountability of the National Care Service due to a number of reasons that we've outlined. That was a lengthy decision that was taken by COSLA leaders. We've been in discussions and negotiations with the government for an extended period. At this stage, our position is that we've withdrawn from that process, and we want to work with partners and others on the reform that we think that needs to go into the system right now to see those changes that are required to support people that require that support.
Yeah, and I think just to add to what Councillor Kelly said, Ms Harper, the leaders took that decision after a lengthy period of negotiation around the shared accountability arrangement, and in that arrangement we don't feel that at the moment that reflects the discussions that we had with the Scottish Government over a long period of time. Let me be clear though, COSLA are fully supportive of reform of the system. They are still in favour of a National Care Service, but we're not in favour of a National Care Service as it's set out in the legislation at the moment. And I think you'll have seen from our evidence, when we go back, we started negotiations when April 2023, something like that. We had a long period of negotiation where we talked about policy, and there was a lot of compromise and there was a lot of discussion and a lot of negotiation with government around. We'd actually got to the stage by June 2023, before the amendments were laid, the draft amendments were laid, we'd got to the stage where we realised that we were down to three issues where we couldn't get agreement. One of those was direct funding of IJBs, one of those was children's services, and one of those was the removal of members from IJBs by ministers. And when we got to that stage, we thought, we'd done a lot of work, the principles, the charter, the national board was more or less kind of nailed down as far as we were concerned. But unfortunately, we knew that government were producing amendments. We hadn't seen the amendments, and you'd seen that from our submission. We then, the amendments were laid. We got them an hour before, and we'd only been in a room with them for about an hour, so they were pretty detailed amendments. We couldn't really get a chance to go over them. And when the amendments were laid, and then we looked at those, there were issues for us, particularly around the National Board, the Shared Accountability Agreement, and the ability for ministers to move services from, a may delegate to a must delegate. So that was, but we still support reform. As far as the National Care Service goes, we're supportive of it, but not in the form it is in the bill at the moment. I hope that sort of...
So, and you talked about direct funding, children, removal of members from IJBs. In your negotiations with the Scottish Government and the tripartite agreement that came to be what was the way to move forward, would you think that... Well, I'm thinking about what additional reform would you like to see? What fundamental changes needs to happen now?
I'll let Councillor Kelly come in, sorry.
I think, as Eddie's highlighted, you know, we were very much in extensive negotiating over a long period with the government. We felt there were three areas where we'd reached where we felt there wasn't an ability for local government to support it. And then subsequently, when the draft amendments were laid, there was substantial other areas. Like it rose to seven different areas, as Eddie said. We're very concerned that what it looks like now is that sort of centralisation, bureaucracy, additional layers of governance that really isn't what the system's looking for right now. We work extensively with the government and partners in the current issues that are facing the system through things like the CRAG, the whole system improvement group, the statement of intent. You know, what we're being told by those who work in social care and those who use our services is the need for that investment, that look at recruitment and retention, these key issues that need to be delivered on right now, and we don't think in its current format the National Care Service is going to deliver on that, and if anything it's going to add that level of bureaucracy to the system that's already struggling, and we believe there's lots of areas where we could work on improvement and are committed to work on improvement, but we don't think it currently takes the format of the National Care Service Bill.
Last week we, as part of the evidence, it was raised that we've got an example of East Ayrshire, North Ayrshire and South Ayrshire in terms of delayed discharge. There's one health board but three different local authorities. One of the local authorities is doing really, really well with addressing delayed discharge. So it isn't part of the reform and support of care boards having a national care service so that we can identify why it's working really well in one area and then the other two local... That's only one example, but there are other local authorities that are struggling with delayed discharge, so isn't part of the reform to look at why it's working in one area and others are not?
Good morning, committee. I'm Louise Long. I'm the Solace rep, and apologies for being slightly late. I got caught in security. And I suppose I have the pleasure of being a chief executive, a chief officer and a chief social work officer. And I've worked in a number of different local authorities, and one of the Ayrshires, actually. And it's very different because of the different needs of different communities. Even the three Ayrshires are very different in relation to some of the things that they do, some of the third sector organisations that they have. So you can't always compare. It's not like comparing apples with apples. Sometimes, you know, Highland, say Glasgow, is apples and pears. And so the issue, I think, for the improvement and being able to scale up improvement and disseminate, we're doing that through the Promise Board. We do that through in relation to children's services all the time, and we don't need legislation to do that. What we really need to do is think about how we drive improvement across the totality of the system.
I can add to that, if that's OK. You're right, we've been working fairly intensively with the Scottish Government on the joint mission to reduce delayed discharge. And I think it's fair to say that, you know, there's been a fair amount of intervention from ministers, and Councillor Kelly's been involved in that as well, in local areas. You know, we're working with civil servants to support those areas. And I think the Ayrshire one, you know, I've heard that, I've heard the example used. But as Louise says, even within that Ayrshire, in that area of Ayrshire, there are very different circumstances. We know, for instance, that North Ayrshire, you know, will face particular issues around care homes. You know, we've been working really intensely with South Ayrshire as well, and they've got completely different circumstances from North Ayrshire, you know, and then East Ayrshire is different again. I think the issue for us is that what would make the biggest difference, you know, and the way the bill's framed at the moment is about it's about ministers having the power to intervene and to set strategic direction. And the way that the bill's framed at the moment also means that ministers can we thought the board would be able to set through these things, but ministers, you know, it'll be about ministers doing it, not doing it in partnership with us. And at the moment, we are intervening. You know, we are doing that, and we're, you know, there's been some progress in delayed discharge, but it's a very kind of difficult and complex issue. So I think, you know, for us, it's, you know, everywhere we go. And we've been out in most local authorities, and we've been there with civil servants and ministers as well. The issue that we hear about is workforce. and not able to get the workforce to provide that care at home. You know, a shortage of social workers. These are the issues that we need to do. It's not clear to us how the legislation is going to deal with a workforce issue, you know, when in fact that's something we could probably do without legislation. But we all know that there are workforce issues across the piece.
So just a final wee question. Yeah, just in the agreement, though, working with COSLA, ministers having this ability to co-design a framework bill, because it's a framework bill, and then build on that with further legislation. Wouldn't a continuation of negotiation support what the challenges you're describing are, you know, in terms of, you know, standardising of the competency requirements for all staff across Scotland, for instance? That's part of it. The bill might not address shortage of staff, but it would look at how do we approach the engagement that's required to have a workforce that could be paid equally, for instance, across the whole of Scotland. So that's my understanding of the whole co-design, joined-up approach to working for ultimately creating a national care service that would work across Scotland with the local levels that are required, as Louise is describing.
Mm. Well, I mean, I think that, you know, the way the bill is framed at the moment is about governance. And it's about structure. So you've got what we thought we would have a shared accountability arrangement between council leaders and Scottish ministers. You would then have the national board, which in our view should set the strategic direction. It would set national standards. You know, we would have a national strategy for social care. We've never had a national strategy for social care, amazingly, in this country. So the board would drive that, you know, and then you would have the relationship between the national board and the local boards, the IJBs, or I think government, what you call them, local care boards. And that's all, you know, that's all fine. That's about governance. Within that, it is difficult to see how that would deal with pay, terms and conditions and workforce. COSLA are working closely with the Scottish Government around fair work, you know, and the fair work agenda. So we're pushing that as far as we can, but that's come up against one really quite fundamental issue, and that is finance. I think, you know, we all recognise the state the public finances are in, and I think when it comes to fair work. So, and I know that there are, you know, colleagues and trade unions would be frustrated about that, but that's separate from the national board. It's really difficult, I think, for us to see, and I don't know if my colleagues will want to come in on that, how that governance arrangement and that government structure will actually change the relationship that we have locally. I mean, we've got our bargaining structures in local authorities. We've got the Scottish Joint Council. You know, there's people, you know, that deals with the local government workforce. You know, and I know that there have been discussions going on around sectoral bargaining with third, and independent sectors. You know, but again, those are kind of separate from the legislation as well. So, you know. But as you say, Ms Harper, you know, it is a framework bill, you know, and obviously there's more detail that we need to see. But in terms of our position on negotiating, you know, we're always open to discussion. You know, this is too important. You know, the bill. This is about people's lives and about the care that we deliver. I don't think there's anybody in this room doesn't want to see improvement in the system. But ultimately what we have got is, you know, we've got a kind of fundamental difference over some really, really, really sticky issues. So, but we're always open to discussion.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Tess White.
Thank you. If I can ask Councillor Kelly, please. So, Councillor Kelly, in your opinion, how can the National Care Service go ahead without the cooperation of COSLA?
Well, it just goes back to the point that, you know, we never, as Eddie's touched on, never wanted to reach this position. You know, we've very much been part of this process extensively since April 23, and certainly have had discussions with all the various cabinet secretaries at different times on this since I've taken my post in June 22. And we've really tried very, very hard to reach a position where we can support a national care service that delivers the changes that we all want to see. What became difficult in those negotiations, and just to answer your question about how, you know, what is the next kind of stage, we got to the point where, you know, it's not negotiating anymore if you're putting forward the points, which we were extensively, and we're not really being listened to. You know, we were quite clear, we had compromised in a number of areas, and there was really three outstanding matters that we wanted to see that kind of compromise. And then when the draft amendments were laid and we only got an hour to look at them, that then led to significant other areas that really put at threat, you know, in terms of the role of local government, local decision-making in the process of social care, and led to us really significant concerns about what this would actually deliver, other than, as I've referenced, that sort of bureaucracy, increased governance and things that really won't make a difference to the system.
So if, let's say, the next step would be that COSLA is just bypassed, so what's your view of that, if the Scottish Government just bypassed COSLA and go to the councils?
Well, in terms of, obviously, the Cabinet Secretary referenced having discussions with councils with COSLA. COSLA is obviously the representative membership body of the 32 local councils who are absolutely committed to COSLA taking on issues of significance like the National Care Service, like budgets, etc., in discussions with the Scottish Government, and leaders have certainly stuck to that position. It's up to the Cabinet Secretary if he wants to have those kind of discussions with local authorities, but I do think it would inevitably come back to COSLA. We've been clear as part of withdrawing that we want to focus on the here and now and the issues that the system's facing. We're already, as I've outlined, doing extensive work with the Scottish Government around some of the key areas around recruitment, retention of staff, financial vulnerability of authorities, etc. And we're absolutely committed to doing that and working with partners. We've made clear our position in the National Care Service Bill, and it's up to the parliamentarians and the government to decide the next stages.
So are you saying that it's just part of the negotiating tactics, or are you saying that there is a very real issue that COSLA could be bypassed?
It's not part of negotiating tactics. I mean, this is taking a significant amount of discussion and thought to come to this process for leaders to withdraw from shared accountability. That's because we have quite significant concerns about the direction of the National Care Service Bill as it currently stands and the impact it could have on service users, on our workforce. So in terms of, you know, how we take it forward, you know, we're still open to having discussions with the government and others around the kind of current reform of the system.
Okay, so just one follow-up question. So if COSLA is bypassed and the Scottish Government go directly to the councils, many of the councils just don't want the National Care Service anyway, and there's huge issues. I was looking in the submissions before, take for example Aberdeenshire Council, just saying, could you not focus on staff retention, attraction and retention, pay? So if COSLA continue to withdraw their support and the councils don't support this bill and its proposed implementation, is it completely dead in the water?
That's not a position that COSLA can take. That's up to parliamentarians and you know, the Scottish Government. As I say, what we'll do is represent the view of those local authorities. Collectively, all local authorities and leaders were behind the submission that we made to the committee, which showed the quite serious concerns we have in a variety of different areas. What we will absolutely do and what leaders want us to do is focus on the issues we all know that social care and service users are facing right now, which are very significant issues.
Thank you, Convener.
Joe Fitzpatrick.
Two very, very quick questions. Firstly, does COSLA think that the bill is improved by the Stage 2 amendments, or does that make it worse? Would you prefer without the Stage 2 amendments, which obviously haven't yet been passed? And secondly, have you done any work on amendments of your own that you might ask MSPs to bring forward during the Stage 2 process, which we're about to go to? We're in this unusual situation of a pre-Stage 2. So these amendments have been laid, but they've not been voted on yet.
Obviously, we have significant concerns with some of the draft amendments that have been laid, and we've outlined that in our submission. I think our disappointment was the fact that we thought there were three key areas that we've kind of outlined, that they were the ones that kind of we were focused on in those negotiations, and then when the draft amendments were laid, and we only had that 1 hour period to look at them, which we were told wouldn't be the case, we'd get more advance notice so we could have that proper discussion. We then had substantial other concerns, which included around national accountability, how the board would look, and actually deviated a lot from those discussions that we'd had with the Scottish Government and the Cabinet Secretary and ministers.
Yeah. I wanted to add to that, Mr. Patrick. Just to give a wee bit of detail on some of the kind of sort of major concerns that we've got around the amendments. I think you know, Councillor Kelly's laid out our kind of broad issues. The bill gives a power. Or would give a power to ministers to move local authority services from a may delegate category to a must delegate category. Now, that could include things like well, it would include children's services. I think ministers have been quite clear they want to see children's services all sitting under the National Care Service Board. It would also include, it could include homelessness services. Now, not all local authorities, and, you know, Louise can talk to that. I mean, Inverclyde have got, you know, are kind of fully delegated, and it might be useful to hear from Louise on that. But it could include homelessness. But that, you know, those are local decisions, the way that how those services are delivered because of local circumstances. And, you know, for it would then mean that if they were all in the must delegate category, that that was a central decision that local services have to be delegated. You know, under the auspices of the National Board. And if you move across to that, you know, if those services are then under the National Board and that shared accountability and the strategic direction is set, or the accountability is, in our view, overly focused on Scottish ministers, you know, that means then that ministers are directing local services in a particular way. That's how we see the bill. I know the government may disagree with that, but that's how we see the bill is set out at the moment. And then, you know, with the other bit to where we've got a concern is around the National Board. Now, originally our vision of the National Board had been about support, it had been about improvement, it had been about national standards, and it had been about the National Board setting the strategic direction, advising ministers and leaders on issues, and also supporting local improvement as well, you know, and monitoring. There is there's a support and improvement framework that we've agreed that there should be a support and improvement framework, you know, but at the moment it isn't about support and improvement, you know, for us. The way the bill sits at the moment is about monitoring and scrutiny. If we can go back to that, you know, then I think we could make some progress. But at the moment we're pretty far apart. As far as amendments go, yes, certainly we would like to see the bill amended to be to recognise the role that local decision making plays. But Louise, I don't know if you want to add into that. Will you spill your water? Sorry.
In the light of a withdrawal of COSLA's support for the bill, do you still accept that there is a need to amend the Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act 2014 to improve integration of health and social care? And if so, are there adequate options in the secondary legislation in the 2014 Act to allow this?
Well, I'll start in terms of, I mean, we've been very clear in discussions that we want to see reform of integration and what integration looks like. We've also been clear it's very early, as you lay, in terms of 2014. The Public Bodies Act is still fairly recent, and there's still a lot of progress to be made and can be made around integration authorities. So we'd be very clear that what that needs to look like is a supportive role, you know, in terms of how we support integration authorities, integration authority members who have a significant responsibility. But we've been very much up for looking at reform and changes to integration that actually support and empower local decision making and the communities that we represent.
So I was around in the 2014 Act was brought in, and I think that there's learning from that Act, and I think that there's things that we could add to the current legislation to give integrated joint boards more authority. It's not that different from the National Care Board and what's actually in the legislation. You know, how it works is you do a strategic needs assessment in your local area. From that, you do a strategic plan that belongs to your IGB, and then you give directions to your health board and your council. And so, actually, all the tools are currently in the 2014 Act, I think, and I think with some amendments it could be supported to be better.
I mean, in terms of the integration, I mean, I think we have to remember as well that integration is still fairly young. You know, I mean, I know, you know, we're 10 years on, but, you know, it's a complex process, and we had a pandemic in the middle of that. You know, so, you know, we feel that there should be more support for integration, but there also should be more support for integrated joint boards as well. And I think we've discussed that with government. I think we all agree on that. You know, that, you know, members of the IGB should really get more support in terms of what they do. You know, there should be more training for IGB members. You know, absolutely should be. You know, these are the kind of softer reforms that we would like to see that would really make a difference to the integration process.
In light of one of the answers earlier from Mr Kelly, I'm going to ask what discussions you've had with Highland Council and NHS Highland about the impact of the potential changes, because they were in support last week in evidence of the stage two amendments by your government. So in your earlier, you said all council leaders were in support of what you were doing.
All council leaders have supported our submission to the committee and the sort of actions were taken. The most recent dialogue with Highland Council was around the current situation it's facing, and there's been dialogue between the Cabinet Secretary, myself and others with Highland Council in a supportive role around what they're facing. And in terms of the lead agency model, which is obviously different from the rest of the integration positions, then we'd want to see support to Highland Council to move to whatever is, comes into existence. And that looks at the, kind of their current structure and support for them in terms of financially around any changes that would have to take place. And we've been very committed to that dialogue with Highland Council in a very positive way.
I'm not just to add, I mean, you know, just to reiterate, the submission to committee was supported by, you know, the 32 local authorities. I know there are local discussions going on in Highland around the lead agency and where that sits as a result of the amendments. I think that's very much a decision and a discussion for them locally, as it should be. I think, you know, certainly in any kind of discussions we've had with the council about that, you know, they've been quite clear that, you know, if there is any change, that needs to be funded, you know, because there could be significant financial implications of a move from lead agency to the IJB model for them. But again, you know, that's also a matter for Highland.
And a further question.
Thanks.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. I'd like to ask some questions about the care service principles and charter. All of us will have experience of how challenging it is for people to navigate social work complaints processes. The committee's heard in evidence that, to all intents and purposes, local authorities are marking their own homework in this regard, meaning that people have really nowhere to go if their care package is cut or if they're assessed for a certain level of package and then not getting that. How would you see this process should be improved?
Okay, thank you. And thank you for the question. There's the SPSO, there's a lot of complaints processes. You've got the health complaints process, you've got the council complaints process, and then you've got the joint HSCP. And it is complicated. I mean, one of the things in relation to the principles and one of the good things in relation to the original bill was it had advocacy and the right to information and advice. And actually, giving people the right to information and advice as well as advocacy could be done now if additional funding could be put into advocacy services. And it's because it's difficult to navigate, just as it's difficult to navigate the health system on its own or the council system on its own. But when you've got two systems together, it's difficult for service users to navigate that. And it's not easy in relation to thinking how another... my understanding of the bill is that the National Care Board would take in complaints and then give those complaints to us to investigate and then give them back to them. That feels like another layer. You've also got the SPSO, you've also got the health who oversee complaints. It doesn't sound as if we're simplifying, it sounds as if...
So tell me, how do we simplify that? So I think it's always helpful to think about it from the perspective of someone who's, say, perhaps a family member whose care package hasn't been fulfilled. How do we simplify them complaining and getting what they're entitled to?
So there's something about rights and people knowing their rights and knowing where to get advice and get support. And that can be very different in different areas. And that's about making sure that people have the right information, the right advice. Lots of people already have rights. And actually what they don't know is how to complain or make sure that those rights are enforced. The problem in relation to things like care packages is that actually demand outstrips capacity. And so when you don't have workforce, when you don't have... then you can actually provide some of the care. And so there's a balance to be struck in relation to that.
OK. And how do local authorities balance the expectations of, against that reality that you're facing?
So most local authorities, or health and social care partnerships, because it's not the local authorities now, have an eligibility criteria in social work and social care. and that prioritises those in greatest need. It also means that you don't end up doing prevention, and that's exactly what Feely was referring to in the Feely report. Actually, we need to invest more in prevention so that people are not going into crisis. But that is one of the issues in relation to the current system as it lands. And people have a universal right to healthcare services, and they should have a universal right to social care services, but it is a very scarce resource. And even if you had all the money in the land, you don't have the workforce to deliver some of that. So you have to be realistic, and you have to have some system that helps to prioritise for those in the greatest need.
And you spoke there about the importance of service users knowing their rights. Would you be confident that all the services, if you like, and employees across health and social care partnerships understand what rights people have to their services and what those levels are? You spoke about criteria.
I'd be confident that social workers understand eligibility criteria. There's health and social care standards. There's also the care inspectorate standards. There's all sorts of standards that are within health and social care. And that's why I think something like the principles potentially could have been, it could simplify all of that. It would be difficult to say that right across the land, everybody understands what the rights are in relation to whether it be care experienced children or people with learning disability or older people who are in hospital.
OK. And from the perspective of local authorities, what are they currently doing to ensure that complaints and feedback are learned from and improve services?
There's an extensive amount of work that goes on in local authorities around the complaints process and how that feedback is then brought into the system. And that happens in different ways across local authorities across Scotland. It's a really, really important part of the work that the integration authorities, local authorities do in terms of making sure we can support people best when there is issues with their care and social care and packages, etc. And local authorities are continually looking at that and continually going out to communities to have consultation on it. And I think it's a really important piece of work. And just going back to your point, I mean, certainly the NCS principles and the NCS charter, we're generally supportive of those principles. I think they're very, very important. A lot of that work is things that we are undertaking right now, things like fair work and looking at how we can support people as best we can. And the charter itself, again, supportive of that in terms of how we can take that forward. We want to see those improvements, but I think Louise has also made the point that we can't get away from what has been the sort of underfunding of social care for a number of years. You know, local authorities have had significant challenges with their budgets for over a decade, and that has an impact on the social care packages that we can provide for our communities. And certainly from our discussion with local councils and partnerships, I mean, they want to see that support right now so that we can provide that better support for the people that need our services. And I think Louise made a very good point about, you know, there could be money into advocacy and into local partnerships that could help support people navigating the system, whether it's through local authorities, integration or health boards as well.
We'd probably always acknowledge that more money would be helpful for everyone. It's definitely tough times, but it can't always just be about money. And I guess with support for the charter and the principles, and I think everybody wants to achieve the aims that are outlined for the National Care Service, thinking about our citizens and the service users who aren't always getting the best at the moment. COSLA's position, is it that they are open to negotiate and to achieve those aims? I mean, you've spoken about positions that where there's disagreement, but if support for the overarching aims are there, I would imagine that you want to bring this forward, talk more.
Yeah, sorry, I keep doing this. In terms of, you know, obviously, the complaints bit, we have had really, this is a good example of where we've had really constructive discussions around this, you know, and with complaints, there's been extensive kind of discussions and debate with government, and I think, you know, and absolutely we want to kind of get that right. I think we have to make sure though, you know, that when it comes to complaints, you know, that we're streamlining it and we're not adding a layer of complexity, you know. My understanding is that I think Louise said this, it would be a repository of complaints that would be, you know, looked at, but then potentially allocated to the specific complaints body, you know. And if there's a role there for more on how those complaints are addressed and dealt with, then, you know, we would discuss that, you know. So I agree, you know, that but that's one area of the bill that we're quite clear, you know, that we're, you know, we've been working on and we're, you know, and made compromises on as well.
Thank you. Carol Morgan.
Thank you, convener. Morning. I'm interested in asking around the topic of the National Social Work Agency and National Chief Social Work Advisor. So really just obviously our job is to scrutinise the legislation as it's coming through. I recognise the position that yous are taking, but it would be useful for us to have some understanding of how you would feel about the position of Chief Social Work Advisor and also how that would link in terms of local authorities.
Sure. I'll maybe touch on the first part and then hand over to Louise. Obviously, on the National Social Work Agency, you know, as the reasons have been outlined, is something we've been very supportive of as COSLA, and we've done extensive work with the Scottish Government on that National Social Work Agency, and it's something that we would like to continue to push forward on and keep those discussions going. There's a lot of really important areas that's covered under that agency that we think could make improvements to the system that really needs that support right now. And Louise, you touch on the Chief Social Work position.
So from a Solace position, we're supportive of the National Social Work Agency. Anything that helps our very valuable social work staff to feel valued, to stay in the career, to have a pathway of support for social workers can only be a good thing. I think it's missing an opportunity because the social work profession, although very important, and I am a social worker, so I would say that, is only part of the adult social care world. There is a lot of social care workers, and it would have been helpful to have some leadership in relation to that through a national social work agency. But there's a whole range of support out there, whether it be from professional bodies, and I know you've heard from Social Work Scotland, and Solace for a national social work agency, because we understand that it's to put social work on a better footing with colleagues like colleagues in education and nursing, actually.
Yeah, of course. Yeah,
thanks so much. This is another area, again, you know, where we've been working pretty extensively with Scottish Government and the Office of the Chief Social Work Advisor. You know, and we're very supportive of that. And what we're supportive of is a kind of partnership approach to social work with, you know, with Social Work Scotland, with COSLA, with the Scottish Government, and just looking at what a social work agency would do. You know, we're talking about workforce planning, we're talking about having a kind of national strategy around social work, we're talking about implementation of support with social work employers to ensure Scotland achieves its policy intentions, training and professional development. So it has been a really kind of positive discussion that we've had on that.
One follow-up, if you don't mind. So, you know, I've listened to what you said and it's helpful for our scrutiny of the bill. Can I ask, do we need the legislation that comes from the National Care Service to do this stuff, or is it things that we could or should be doing now?
Yeah, I think I can handle to lose it, but that's an area where we'd like to just let's do it right now. You know, I think it'd be up to, obviously, Government and parliamentarians decide the requirement of legislation, but it's something we certainly think we can get on with. There's a lot of areas covered that we're in discussion with. We're not waiting for, you know, we know the situation that faces social work right now, and support for the staff in social work, and getting social people into social work is really important. So that's something that, yeah, absolutely, we'd want to work on, no matter what.
To be honest, it probably doesn't need to be in legislation. You know, what's in the legislation is establishing the Chief Social Work Advisor as in legislation. You know, I think there are merits to that, and, you know, we've discussed that with the Chief Social Work Advisor in terms of, you know, influence and how that can influence within government. But, you know, I think we would need to have a wee bit more discussion with them around how that, you know, how that looks as a partnership, you know, because I think what they're looking at is an executive agency, is my understanding. So I think it has to be a partnership. You know, we've got the statutory responsibility for the workforce. Social Work Scotland do the kind of professional development bit of it, and the government have obviously got an interest as well. So I think we need to think more about whether that's necessary and how the partnership would work. Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Paul Smealy.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the members of the panel so far. I just want to turn to commissioning and procurement in the bill. And more generally, what appetite is there from COSLA members to undertake fundamental reform of social care that would further embed integration? We often hear about variation across the country. So just to understand particularly how we can work to improve the experience of those seeking care and support, is there an appetite from COSLA to undertake that effort?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. And that's something that's key for us in terms of we, you know, there's variation across the country for a variety of reasons. I mean, what we wouldn't want to see is those local voices lost in that local decision making, because there's different issues that face, you know, something in Shetland and accessing services and what Shetland faces in terms of recruitment, retention of staff, to the issues that are faced in areas like Glasgow, etc. So there's, you know, that's why it's very important, and something we get feedback from users a lot is that they want to see local decisions taken at a local level that reflect the needs and requirements of the communities. But there's common themes across the country. There's common themes around recruitment, retention of staff and funding into the system. And those are common themes that we really have to work on right now, you know, in terms of that's been very clear with the Scottish Government. If we want to see those improvements to integration, we want to see those improvements in partnerships, then these are the areas that we need to see urgently, see work on, because that social care workforce are doing a really tremendous job in the most difficult circumstances with some of the most vulnerable individuals.
Yeah, I mean, just on the commissioning point, again, we've had, I keep referring back to where we've actually got agreement on a lot of things, and, you know, we've had fairly positive discussions on commissioning as well. You know, Councillor Kelly's touched on the variation bit, but, you know, there is a case, you know, for national commissioning of certain services, and that's something that we've been, you know, we've been in discussions with, and we did, you know, we recognised that the national board might have a role in undertaking national commissioning on agreed and complex specialist services, and I think that's why it's so important that we get the shared accountability arrangement right, you know, so that we're making decisions on those issues jointly with government. As I said before, we feel as though the balance is out at the moment in terms of ministers taking that control in that direction. So, but certainly in terms of when it comes to the national question, we can see that. And Louise, I don't know if you want to add to that, if that's okay.
The only thing to add is we asked about ethical commissioning, and it's disappointing that ethical commissioning doesn't have a more prominent part in the second part of the bill. Because fair work is different from ethical commissioning. Fair work, the local government are working with Scottish Government across the piece to look at fair work, but actually ethical commissioning would go a long way to supporting the workforce who work in the third and private sector to make sure that they feel valued, like the social work agency, that they feel valued, and to make sure that they feel engaged, because we need to keep as many people working in social care as we possibly can. And there is an opportunity in relation to commissioning to do something different.
Proposed amendments, as I understand it, remove an explicit reference to ethical commissioning. Do you or any members of the panel have a view on how best to realise ethical commissioning? Is it through the NCS bill on the face of the bill or through some sort of secondary legislative provision?
I'll start, if that's okay, in relation to... So, ethical commissioning is expensive. It's more than people's terms and conditions or travel in relation to work. There is a whole range of, make sure that we ethically commissioned home care services in Inverclyde over a long period of time. It took a lot of work and it took a lot of input. And it was very expensive in comparison with others. And so I think if we really are committed to ethical commissioning, we will need to put more funding in relation to it. And that's very difficult when the resources are so scarce.
Would you prefer to see that on the face of the bill or is that your preference?
If we're looking at social care as a whole system and we want to make the whole system better, I think ethical commissioning should be in it.
I just want to turn to the point Mr. Follin made around new Section 12M, I believe, of the bill about the reserve procurement process, and just ask in detail what your view is on that amendment as proposed to enable the National Care Service Board to procure goods and services on behalf of other public bodies or the Scottish ministers.
I think we probably need to take a look at that more closely, okay. Mr. Sweeney. I think that there's something around the kind of broader role of the National Board and the kind of detail in the way that the Board would work that we've not really kind of got to yet. I think in principle we need to you know, the kind of principal position from us would be that certainly, you know, where we have it, it would have to align with local decision making, you know, and it would have to align with kind of local finance and budgetary arrangements as well. But I mean, I can certainly come back to you on that if that's okay.
No problem. Is there any other points on that you would like to make?
Maybe Louise.
I suppose you could see a case for a procurement by a national body for something like the secure estate. It's very, very expensive for a young person to be held in secure accommodation. And you could see that actually across the country, private and third sector organisations are running the secure estate. You could see a case where you would have a nationally procured secure estate in order to reduce costs across and also make sure there's capacity. But I think you would need to understand the detail in relation to and get agreement to make sure that what you're procuring on a national basis adds value and isn't it actually distracting from what people need locally.
There has been some concerns raised by stakeholders and submissions about the interaction between Scotland XL and local authorities and how this new board would intersect with that. Is that a concern that you share?
In the Solus submission, you'll see that we mentioned Scotland XL. We've had a very successful relationship with Scotland XL over a number of years, who commission on behalf of local authorities and who have a framework that we all buy off. And it's long established and it provides high quality and services to local authorities. So I think that's exactly what we need to think about when we think about the interface between what the National Care Service wants to do and the bodies that are already there, whether that be Scotland XL, whether that be the Care Inspectorate, whether that be the SPSO. It's actually trying to work out how all these things weave together.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think it's that lack of clarity, really, in those relationships, which is one of the issues that we have. You know, we don't really know how that would work. And as Louise said, you know, local government, local authorities have got a fairly kind of strong relationship with Scotland XL. I know that Scotland XL as well are working hard with other providers, you know, in terms of how they work with them as well. And we've had kind of discussions with them in recent weeks around that. So. This is the kind of secondary legislation bit of things that you know, commission is a complex area, you know, and procurement, as is procurement, sorry.
But just what level of consultation has been carried out between government and yourselves in relation to this? I mean, Cargom, for example, has in its submission said we do not observe anything in Section 12M that will change the existing approach being used in Sofia, that fundamental procurement orthodoxy will continue to dominate at the expense of strategic, collaborative and thoughtful commissioning. It seems like that surely must have come up in consultation.
There's been discussions around, you know, the commissioning processes, but we don't have the detail in terms of how it would work.
Right, OK. That seems to be a shared view. OK, thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Earlier on, we've talked about a few of the things that that everybody has some concerns around, but there are parts of the bill that people do actually agree on and that should be implemented. There have been delays in implementing ANZLAW, and we've heard from care home relatives about their concerns about that implementation. Pending its implementation, are the two new health and social care standards introduced in 2022 sufficient to ensure residents in care homes can maintain meaningful connections? Why are those delays there, and what else could be done to help support the implementation of ANZLAW?
So, people have a right to a family life, so that's already enshrined. And I think in relation to ANZLAW, both COSLA and Solus are supportive in relation to that. I have looked at the two standards in relation to, because I was involved in establishing care home visiting during the pandemic. In my role as a chief officer, and so I've taken a keen interest in what we're doing in relation to our care homes who are inspected by the care inspector, and those inspections are really important. So, and there's also been a care home collaborative that's been done, and the care inspector have been doing some work to look at how they can improve people's experience in care homes. I would be confident that anybody in the system doesn't want to keep people away from their family. I think during COVID, people were really scared. They didn't know. They were taking public health advice. I think now that we're better informed, now that the Care Inspectorate have got it in their standards, and I am still very supportive of Anne's Law, I think we're in a better place about making sure that people get access to their family and feel connected, actually, because it's more than just access to their family.
So are the two standards sufficient in your view then?
I think those standards go a long way to giving us some reassurance that things are happening now and that we don't have to wait until 2028 for things to be implemented.
OK. What are your views on the intention to bring social work services together, particularly given the potential inclusions of children's services within the National Care Service, the pattern in which things are included or not across the country at the moment and the potential difficulties that could cause?
Paul, maybe we start. Obviously, that's one area where we have expressed significant concern around children's services and justice services, and whether they fit within councils or in partnerships, and on the bill itself, the ability of ministers to decide where that lies, and everything within integration and the new care boards. So we're very, very concerned by that. We don't see any evidence that will improve the situation or improve the system right now. And we've been very clear that local government wants to see that local decision making remain at a local level for local authorities and partnerships to take. And we're clear that it's very important that in terms of the current system is aligned to children's service and justice, to the work of councils and partnerships.
I wonder if I could come here. I'm an all-in integration. We have homelessness, children's justice and adult services. And I suppose one of the things, and I think the last time Solus presented to committee, they talked about the length of time, the amount of time, energy and resources that goes into a long piece of legislation. And the panel, the committee will know that CELSID does some research for Scottish Government, which says that children's services is in crisis. I am now concerned about the instability of moving things around when actually we know there is a crisis in children's services, when we know that children require to be supported, the local authorities are trying to bring in the promise, and we're talking about moving children's services out of a partnership with education in different places across the country. I would remain concerned that actually children's services has now recovered from COVID, so I probably feel more strongly than my colleagues in COSLA in relation to this, that this is about a timing thing. And it's also about making sure that services are safe and that staff feel supported. And I think that staff in children's services want direct support. What they don't want is more governance and more layers and things to be confusing. In fact, CELSIS talks about them wanting clarity.
That's great. What parts of the bill would the panel like to see progress, whether that's a personal opinion or one on behalf of the organisations that you represent? Because there are, notwithstanding the fact that Anne's Law could, in theory, be progressed outside of the piece of legislation, I very much recognise why carers' organisations, lived experience and a lot of other people want to see some of these things enshrined in law so that they're not negotiable. What things would the panel like to see progress? And Eddie's nodding the most, so I'll go to Eddie first.
A personal perspective, if you don't mind. We've been quite clear. You know, we're really supportive of Anne's Law. I think the other thing, the single shared record is really important. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, and COSLA, we've done, you know, a significant amount of work on our kind of data and digital work in relation to social care and the role that data and digital can play. Not only in making it a much better experience for people who are using services, but also that, you know, it can help alleviate pressures on the system if we get our data and digital right. So we're doing work around kind of, you know, CAI, the CAI number in local government, how you translate that. So I think the single shared record is crucial and central to that. So we would kind of really like to see that progress. And we've talked about things like, you know, sort of principles and charters and stuff like that. I mean, if you go to the charter, for instance, you know, do we need legislation for a charter? You know, probably not, because we're working on charters and other aspects as well. You know, and the thing about a charter as well is that it needs to be deliverable. It needs to be have somewhere that's got resource. So there's those things. You know, there's stuff that we do want to see that would improve outcomes and improve the situation for people who are using services.
Just also, I mean, that, we talked about the National Social Work Agency and the work, the extensive work that's going on there. You've touched on the right to break for carers. I mean, that's something that we're very, very keen to develop and to move on. You know, it's really, really important, and we need to. That's something that COSLA is absolutely committed to working with the government on. We talked about Anne's Law and other areas. And then also, really, what we're looking at, and we've said a few times, is you know, an acknowledgement of the current issues that are facing the system. You know, the really important issues around funding, recruitment, retention of staff. These are issues that we all need to collectively work on right now.
That's great. Thanks, Mina.
Sandra Gohan.
Thank you, Convener. Declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. Councillor Kelly, you said earlier that COSLA had pulled away from shared accountability, and yet paragraph 80 of the memorandum talks about the importance of shared accountability. Given unions have withdrawn support with the STUC, the latest one, and now COSLA withdrawing support, and hearing most of Civic Scotland is united against the NCS, it seems to me the bill is dead in the water. But Marie Todd, the Social Care Minister, has said COSLA walking away shows total disregard for the people we serve. So if the NCS is pushed through in its current form, what do you feel will happen to the sector?
I think we've been very clear in our submission and the evidence we're given that the very serious concerns we have of the impact that the bill in its current format will have on service users and those that access social care in our workforce. We haven't seen evidence that it will lead to the improvements that we're all looking for. If anything, that additional level of bureaucracy and governance could lead to significant concerns around those services. And certainly, it's not dealing with the issues that we currently face. In terms of the comments of the Minister, I mean, I want to be clear that local authorities, local councils and partnerships at the heart of everything we do is those with lived experience and those service users. They're absolutely vital to us. They direct very much at a local level decisions that we take. And certainly we know the process that many of lived experience have gone through as part of this bill process. And we certainly don't want to lose any of those experiences or voices. We're absolutely committed to continuing in the current situation we're in to having dialogue and discussion with those individuals because we want to see reform of the system as soon as possible. It's just we cannot, as we've said, support the National Care Service Bill in its current format.
Okay. So I'd like to look at how we can try to evaluate what's going on. Looking at the bill, I believe there's no references to rights, accessibility, ethical commissioning, procurement, quality, ethical commissioning, I think, and also we've just heard also that Children's Services is currently in crisis. So how are we supposed to evaluate this bill if it's brought in and what actually happens to people on the ground?
Well, I think in our evaluation, obviously, it's clear in our submission that we have very significant concerns and we want to, obviously, some of the areas you've listed are areas where we were negotiating. But as I've mentioned earlier, when the amendments were laid in draft form, there was additional concerns that, you know, were quite serious for local government in terms of decision-making and process. And, I mean, all we can say is these areas are very, very concerning to us. We're concerned about the impact it could have, as we've mentioned, on those service users and our workforce. I don't know if Eddie, you want to add anything there?
I mean, I think because, and you'll have heard these concerns before, because it's a framework bill, you know, there is a lack of detail on how it will be eventually look and how it would be implemented as well. And we know in Scotland, you know, that we acknowledge that, you know, what we have in legislation and implementation can sometimes look very, very different. So I think that kind of lack of detail kind of hampers us a bit as well in terms of what you would see in the legislation finally and how that would actually apply locally and how it would kind of change the system as well. So, I mean, I guess you know, that's something that you would see in time. You know, but we have expressed a concern previously, you know, that with secondary legislation that is subject to less scrutiny. And, you know, if we were in discussions with the government about this, we would want to kind of be discussing what secondary legislation was going to look like. But at the moment, we're not.
Okay, thank you. It has been suggested that there was a huge political divide in COSLA about you, about your position. So what I would like to know is there a huge political divide? And you know, what is your absolute current position?
In terms of the submission we've made, as I referenced earlier, there's absolutely no political divide within COSLA. All leaders are signed up to that submission. And all the concerns that we've raised at committee, you know, that's we're directed, obviously, as a membership organisation to leaders. In terms of whether we were to continue with discussions with the government or whether it was to withdraw from the National Care Service, that obviously went to leaders. They had a debate on it and they took that decision to withdraw. Where it leaves us right now is we've withdrawn from the shared accountability, and we want to focus on, as we've mentioned a few times, the reform that currently needs to be seen in the system. And we are working extensively with the Scottish Government in both the current pressures that are facing the system, blade discharge, etc., and also the sort of medium to longer term areas, and we want to see that as a focus, and we're committed to working with our stakeholders, whether it's trade unions who've made clear their own opinion of the National Care Service Bill in its current format, or stakeholders or service users or third sector, we're absolutely committed to working with them around the reform that's required. But at this stage, as I say, we've withdrawn from that process of shared accountability.
OK. And one of the areas, Louise, that you spoke about that reform is desperately needed was children's services. So what reform can we do now, or do we have to wait for an NCS to do those reforms? And once we put those reforms in, what is the success criteria and how do we go about looking at that?
So you've had the submission, I believe, from The Promise. So The Promise is focused on care experience, young people, and trying to keep young people with their families and make sure that we improve our outcomes in relation to them. And so there's a commitment, there's work that's already going on in the system. The issue that we've got in children and families is that we've got a very, and I know that you've heard from Social Work Scotland, but we've got a very young workforce with very inexperienced social workers who all work really hard and who are really dedicated and who want to make a difference to children's lives. But we have people who are very experienced who are leaving, and you used to have a mixed economy. And so that's why we support the social work agency, so whatever we can do to value social workers to encourage them to come in and stay in the profession. And what we would see is less children coming into care, less children being involved in the children's hearing system, early support for families, and family support that's easily accessible, that people can get in their own community. And each of the areas across Scotland funded through the Scottish Government have developed their own family wellbeing service. And they're all slightly different because we are all slightly different. You will have a different service in Argyll and Buttes than you will have in Inverclyde. And I think that's a good indication of like earlier help, earlier intervention to try and make sure that we stem the people coming into crisis further up the system. But that will take time because the service is still recovering from COVID. Young people still have significant issues in relation to mental health, and therefore it needs stability.
Thank you. My final question. The Scottish Government told the BBC on the 27th of September that it was extremely disappointed that some COSLA leaders had chosen to frustrate progress towards the National Care Service. Do you feel that is an accurate representation? And did you engage with the government after the amendments came out? And if you did, what was the timeline of the response you got?
I don't think that's an accurate representation. I think we've been clear today about how extensive our negotiating and discussions have been with the Scottish Government, and we've been very honest and upfront about our concerns. We have engaged when the draft amendments were laid. As I said, we were disappointed we only got an hour to look at them, considering our significant involvement in those discussions. I know we wrote from all of the some of the spokespeople at COSLA, we wrote to the Cabinet Secretary, and then we followed it up with a subsequent letter to the Cabinet Secretary in September. and I had a meeting with them to discuss some of our concerns, and we got a response to that in a sort of formal letter the day before leaders. So we have tried at every stage to have discussions and dialogue with the Scottish Government, and made it very, very clear our position at every stage. And also, as we've shown today, we have been more than willing to compromise. At the heart of everything we want to do at local government is to deliver the changes that our communities and service users need and require right now, and that's been what's driving us in every decision we've taken.
Thank you.
Thanks. I've got a few questions, just I suppose as follow-ups to some of the issues that other committee members have raised. I've heard a few times, I think, from yourself, Councillor Kelly, about talking about only having an hour before the amendments were published, but of course they are amendments, they're draft amendments at the moment, they've not been voted on. Joe Fitzpatrick asked a specific question about COSLA amendments, which I didn't hear answered. So can you tell me, has COSLA drafted amendments for stage two?
Sorry, I shouldn't answer that specifically. No, we haven't at this stage. If we remain in the situation that we're in, you know, where we're looking to influence the bill from the outside, if you like, we would look at bringing amendments on that. I think it's important to explain, you know, that it was a very collegiate and constructive year of discussion as we moved along. And as I said before, there was a lot of compromise and a lot of negotiation and a lot of hard work going in from officers and officials on both sides, not just COSLA, but local government officers and Scottish Government officials, a wide range of Scottish Government officials. I think there was a genuine kind of disappointment, and we did ask to see the amendments as we went along, because we knew that, you know, what's in the policy may not translate exactly to what the legal amendment might be. You know, so we did want to see those, so that if there were issues with it, we could sort those out. You know, we could get to a point where we could say, right, OK, that doesn't work so well for us, what could we do here? And we'd go through that process, but we never got there with that. Yeah. We never seen them, you know. I mean, we had an hour in a room with them, but they're complicated amendments. You need more time than that.
So if things remain as is, then we can expect to see COSLA amendments?
Yes.
What sort of discussion or notice did COSLA have or give to Scottish Government that they were going to withdraw their support?
Well, I think the first indication that we possibly would withdraw came in February this year, when leaders made it clear that, you know, there wasn't progress in the three areas that we'd discussed, you know, that we'd been talking extensively for a long period and there hadn't been significant progress. And as I said, the impression was that maybe we weren't being listened to around those key areas. And throughout that year, you know, we were very clear with the Scottish Government, with Cabinet Secretary and Ministers, at every stage what leaders were thinking. Probably every single meeting of COSLA leaders that came up and updating the National Care Service, so we were able to articulate back those views, including as we got closer to the decision that leaders took to withdraw, that was a possibility. So we were very, very clear with the Government that could happen.
Okay. So February initially, but obviously there were significant amendments then to National Care Service Bill in response to that over the summer, which is essentially why committee's sitting here re-scrutinising those. You also mentioned, Councillor Kelly, that service users, directors at local level, and about how important service users' input is into providing services. What discussions has COSLA had with stakeholder groups about the withdrawal from support of the NCS Bill, either before or since?
Well, we have a variety of discussions with various stakeholders who will obviously approach us in different ways around the NCS and what's happening with the NCS. And
talking specifically about the decision to withdraw support.
Well, the decision to withdraw support so obviously only came pretty recently, and we're committed to having dialogue with stakeholders and others around our decision to withdraw support.
So there wasn't any beforehand, and there hasn't been any specifically since?
Well,
we've had
discussion with stakeholders and others around the position as it was in the National Care Service. Leaders only took the decision to withdraw relatively recently, and following that decision and other discussions, we'll be back talking to stakeholders. But COSLA is continually talking to stakeholders at every stage of the way. They're a vital partner often to delivering social care, and we want to make sure their views are articulated both through the national care process and all other things that we're involved in terms of looking at reform right now to the system.
So not specifically before, not specifically since on that issue?
Well, we've spoken about the National Care Service with stakeholders.
No, about the withdrawal.
Well, the withdrawal was a clause of leaders' position, so yeah. We couldn't talk to stakeholders about withdrawing when it's up to leaders to decide that. And then after, which has only just recently happened, we absolutely will be talking to stakeholders.
Okay. The other issue that you spoke about, or lots of the issues that you spoke about, was about a lot of consensus between Scottish Government and COSLA, and a lot of support for lots of parts of the bill as drafted. So what's it going to take to get COSLA back around the table?
Well, I think our position is, as I've been very clear, we've withdrawn from the current position of the bill, and it's really over to the Scottish Government. They're very clear in our position, our concerns. We've articulated them for over a year. We've made significant compromise, but the areas of concern are very significant, and I don't think it was particularly easy or helpful for us when we didn't get that notice of the draft amendments being laid and weren't able to have that proper discussion. But it's very much over to the Scottish Government now in terms of how we take that forward. We've been very clear about our position and have articulated that.
You might be very clear with them, but I'm not clear. So what will it take for COSLA to get back around the table? Mr Follin, you want to come in?
Well, I mean, I think if you look at the significant concerns that we've got around the national board and it not setting strategic direction, the fact that the shared accountability agreement at the moment is completely sits with Scottish ministers. It's Scottish ministers' decisions. It's, you know, they have the power to direct, you know, and the fact that they can move council services from a may delegate to a must delegate, you know, the issue around children's services is fundamental to local authorities as well as, you know, I think we've talked about direct funding, you know, and mm-hmm. You know, and I think that's still outstanding to some extent.
So it's those issues.
These are the big issues. Yeah,
issues that have been on the table for quite some time.
Yeah, and we just haven't got a resolution to them, you know. And government wrote to, you know, cabinet secretary wrote to Councillor Kelly the day before leaders, and basically, you know, set out there was some movement in a couple of areas, but the big fundamental issues were not resolved, and government were making it clear that they were intent and kind of carrying on in that direction.
And Emma Harper's got a supplementary.
Thanks. It's just to pick up on the 1 hour to see amendments. What are the circumstances around that? I mean, because I'm looking at the SOLAS response in our briefing papers recognises that there are significant areas that would benefit from a national approach. Leadership and driving improvement, standards, assurance, performance, report and scrutiny, workforce planning, fair work training, ethical commissioning, complex and specialist care commissioning, improvement and innovation, including improving research, and more. There's loads that you can agree on. It's so significant that COSLA have walked away. I'm just wondering, what was the 1 hour circumstances? How is it possible that you had 1 hour to look at amendments?
I won't release confessions of the SOLAS submission, but in terms of in their discussions with the Scottish Government, obviously throughout that process, we asked for more advance notice to look at the draft amendments so we could have dialogue on what that would look like before they were obviously published, and that did take place. And we only got that 1 hour noticed in terms of to look at those draft amendments. So there is a lot of
1 hour before making a decision to support or not.
No, that's 1 hour before they were published, before they were lodged.
Yeah, yeah. In June. Yeah. So the amendments were lodged in June. So two things happened. One, there was a meeting at COSLA where we got to look at the amendments, but it was, you know, we never had time to analyse the amendments and understand, you know, exactly what the implications of them were. And then we seen the amendments when they were lodged an hour before they were lodged. So the bottom line was that we never really had the opportunity to understand what was in the amendments, despite having had almost a year of discussion. And we'd asked all the way along the line can we see the amendments, can we see the amendments, and we never saw those amendments.
In order to make a decision about supporting the amendments?
Well, in order to work on them, to make sure that the amendments reflected the policy discussions that we've been having.
And so... Yeah, I just find it really difficult to understand that you had 1 hour to look at amendments, but then there's June, July, August, September, and now you've walked away. But we've got the amendments, we've got marked up amendments, we've got lots of blue additions, lots of red strike throughs in the pages. I'm trying to understand why the 1 hour is so significant when no decisions were made about the amendments.
I think it's significant. If you've been negotiating for a year in good faith and trying very hard to establish a National Care Service that we all want to see, and you're told throughout that process you will see a draft amendments, and then you're given it as the key partner and one of the key deliverers of social care an hour before they're published, I don't think that is a helpful position. And then, as we've articulated, we went from 3 areas of concern to an additional 7 areas of concern. And these aren't just minor concerns, these are quite serious, significant concerns, as we've put forward in our evidence, and have shown they'll have a significant impact in the delivery of those services and those service users. So I think it's a pretty significant issue.
Okay. Thank you.
For the record, the amendments haven't been lodged. They are proposed amendments, just to keep us all correct. Can I thank the panel for their evidence today, and we'll suspend briefly for a changeover of witnesses. We now continue our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill with a second panel of witnesses. And I welcome to the committee Rachel Caquette, Chief Executive Officer, Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland; Rob Gowans, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland; and Karen Hedge, Deputy Chief Executive of Scottish Care. And we'll move straight to questions, and Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you. I suppose my initial question is, what are your thoughts now on the proposed amendments at Stage 2 of this National Care Service Bill?
It's hard to know. I mean, I've been sitting in the back listening to COSLA evidence this morning, and obviously what we have is a bill that was amended, not lodged, but sitting as an amended bill, in which we didn't ask for, which we had no part in amending in that way, in a shared accountability agreement that wasn't part of what we were looking for, and now a removal of the shared accountability that we also had no part in. So I think we're left with a set of amendments where the status of those amendments feels to us quite uncertain. It's quite hard to know how to work with a bill where we have a bill that can be amended and an amended bill that at the moment can't be because they're not formally lodged. Certainly in the way that the amendments are currently sitting in the paper that was shared in June with, as you said, much red and blue pen all over it, it is a significant departure from the original bill. We have remained committed to working with making sure that this reform, which we wanted when FEELY was published, delivers for the people I represent as not-for-profit providers of social care, and most importantly for the people that they support in communities every day. If we are amending the amended bill, then we still have quite significant concerns, but we are certainly up to working on those. I guess my question is, at the moment, I don't know what to talk about amending at this point in time. I'm not sure of the status of the bill, or indeed whether the joint accountability arrangement will be back on the table if COSLA return to negotiations. And I would just finish by saying it seems ironic to me that we have many of us saying that we feel the bill doesn't go far enough, and a discussion with COSLA and government that seems like the move to keep the status quo is the deciding factor. We feel that feels very far apart from what we think the potential of a National Care Service Bill could be.
Rob?
I think we still continue to support the principle of a sort of National Care Service, and that it's something that's got the opportunity to improve people's experiences of social care if it's done correctly, if it's done in a rights-based, person-centred way. We've been clear throughout that the bill didn't fully meet that and would need substantial amendments at Stage 2. I think from going through the Scottish Government's amendments, I don't think they sort of fully deliver those, so I think sort of further amendments are needed. I think in our sort of call for views, there's something like sort of 30 different areas we've identified that we believe the bill could and should be amended. And I think there's we're sort of committed to, as long as there is a bill, is to work to make it as good as it possibly can be, because it's both because it would have a significant impact on our members, but also because there's potential for improvement. I think it's whilst there are some things that can be done now, we've been clear for a long time that the social care system needs substantial reform, and I think probably the status quo wouldn't address that.
Karen.
Yeah. Hi, thanks. With reference to the bill as it currently stands, I would agree with those who've spoken before that it doesn't meet the full intentions of the independent review of adult social care as written by Derek Feely. I think that the principles of the National Care Service don't necessarily require the bill or a bill to make those changes and improvements to the system. what's left, however, is clearly about power and how that would sit. And obviously, that's up for question. But I guess does at least evidence that people are passionate, that something needs to change here. So I would take that away. Significantly for us, though, the removal of ethical commissioning from the bill and the retention of the paragraph on reserve procurement is a significant concern to our members because of the implications that will have on the sustainability of the sector and therefore the ability to continue delivering care and support to people in Scotland.
Just a final question. Yeah, what's the impact of COSLA walking away in terms of what do you perceive that has that caused damage?
I mean, council leaders need to make the decisions that they need to make for the constituents that they represent. I think we've had a year in which an agreement has been negotiated between national and local government over which those of us, if you believe the winter plan, are meant to be equal partners in social care have had very little influence. So I feel as a civic leader in the sector, to be honest, quite angry about the last year. I feel like we've got a system where, at the end of the last winter, more than 80% of providers in my membership were delivering a public service under public contract at a deficit. We've got people who are struggling to keep services going, and we have got 6,000 people waiting for a social care assessment and more than 3,000 people not getting the care that they've actually been assessed as needing. And remember, with criteria as high as they are, that's the tip of the iceberg of what we're dealing with on a daily basis. So it feels a little bit like we've had a year of negotiation that has come to potentially naught, although let's wait and see if that reopens, when actually we need to do two things. We need to sort the fact that the system is burning now, and actually we have spent too much time waiting now for this change to be negotiated separately. And actually just keeping the status quo going with little changes at the edges is not going to deliver the fundamental reform that Feely suggested. And if this bill has that potential, I guess the one advantage now is perhaps there's a space for all of us who've frankly been sitting waiting to have these conversations, to get involved in trying to shape a bill that might get us closer to Feely than I think either the original or the amended proposed bill has put on the table. That may be the one opportunity that we have, but we can't keep waiting. We need to do both, and it's not one or the other, and it's certainly not codifying the status quo, which doesn't work for people.
Okay. You don't need to operate the microphones. Oh, broadcasting does that.
Thank you.
So with regards to COSLA leaving and the implications that has, really it underlines the specific way that the National Care Service has been developed, and that's really in a bit of a vacuum. You know, there's a lot of people with significant expertise across what is a living system, and they have not had the opportunity to contribute in a way that's effective. So what we have is two statutory bodies and health coming together to have these conversations in a room alone, and that is far, far from the ethos of what the National Care Service should be and the way that it should be developed. So we know that when we negotiate with people, it works better when you have that diverse mix of individuals representing the different parts of the system in that. If we had been having those conversations, taking representation across the whole of the system, we might well be in a different position. But when it's reduced to two individual partners, then it very much highlights the power play in that space.
Thank you.
Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you to Commissioner of Interests of Practising NHSGP. Thank you, panel. It's more than COSLA pulling out. All the unions have all pulled out, and I've been looking at submissions, and no one's in full agreement, so certainly on this panel, that this bill as written is the way that it should be going. And Karen, you spoke quite powerfully about this bill is about where the power sits. So my question is, one, where does the power sit within this bill? And secondly, the reform that you've all said is needed, do we need the NCS to make these reforms, or could we make these reforms now, given that we've spent £28 million on the NCS so far?
Thank you. So to your first question on where does the power sit, so the ethos of the independent review of adult social care was that the power needs to sit with people accessing care and support, needs to sit with the citizens of Scotland. But it's been reduced to, you know, power play between COSLA and between government in this space, and that's not serving the needs of our people currently. So we need to move forward from that and get back to the original principles and the ethos of that. Could you remind me what your second question was? Apologies.
Yeah, so the second question is, given that we've spent £28 million so far on the National Care Service, do we need to have a National Care Service to drive the reforms that you've all said we need, given that Rachel's even spoken about how there's a significant deficit going on?
If I told you that the £28 million that have been spent is the equivalent of a million hours of care at home and housing support that could have been delivered, then does that perhaps tell us what we need to be shifting the focus on? You know, we have significant unmet need there, and that's the equivalent of a significant amount of provision that could have been delivered. We have excellent, you know, I've said this in this room before, maybe not this room, but other rooms. You know, we have some really good legislation, some really good policy in Scotland, but where we fail is that implementation gap. And that is, again, what the bill and the work around the National Care Service to date has not looked at. How do we create the conditions for change? And what is it we need to look at the system in a different way? Actually, what can we take out of the system to make it work more effectively instead of piling more and more and more on? Because that's what's causing it to break, and frankly is where we're seeing duplication and increased expenditure as a result. So if we get back to thinking about, you know, how do we support our social care workforce in this, and frankly how do we pay them a wage that is acceptable, you know, for people who are professionally qualified and professionally registered rather than the £12 an hour that they get at the moment. And that requires paying people who deliver services, the providers, effectively to being able to do that.
Thank you.
Tess Wade.
Thank you, Convener. Question, if I may, to Karen. So, Karen, in your opinion, will the National Care Service help people in care homes who are receiving care?
So with the removal of Anne's Law, which clearly put a significant focus on people living in care homes, then it's yet to be determined what the implication would be for people living in care homes, particularly with the removal of ethical commissioning. So at the moment, government pays care homes £5 per person per hour for each person who lives in that care home, and that's nowhere near enough, you know, to deliver the complex care and support that's required in that space. So the bill as it's currently written doesn't help that. We do have some really good examples of other work that's happening in other parts of the country where people come together. So thinking about Dumfries and Galloway, for instance, it's your part of the world, isn't it? You know, they did some specific work around about collaborative commissioning there. And that was actually about just coming together with different parts of the system, having an honest, open conversation about what's needed, being able to share information about people in a way that was ethically sound, but meant that they could freely move through the system. And that reduced the number of people stuck in hospitals by 28%. So, and actually got them, you know, into the care homes where they needed to be living in their own home space. The National Care Service bill won't change that. You know, it won't change, can people come together and have that conversation in reality in their local space?
One of the issues, though, and it was raised at First Minister's questions last week, was this disparity of care in all the different areas of Scotland. And so the argument is that you need a National Care Service to have a standardised care, by accepting that there's no streamlined funding. So in your opinion, how do you get this standardised, high-quality care?
So I actually don't think we need a once for Scotland. I think we need whatever each individual needs. That's the very difference between social care and health, for instance. You know, each individual person has different wishes, different needs, different requirements. What we need, however, is equity across Scotland. And my concern is that this call for a once for Scotland is shifting from equity, particularly with the removal of the Human Rights Bill. It's shifting away from equity toward how do we build a system which puts more regulation upon services to deliver? When we already have really excellent health and social care standards that exist in play and are already used to regulate services, the problem again is that how do we create the conditions? So without the streamlined funding that will enable that, I don't think it will, no.
Thank you. Just one question for Rachel. So you're 80% of members, and I'm thinking of the voluntary sector in terms of the provision of care homes. They're already, the elastic band is already stretched too far. You said it's a system burning now. So in your opinion, how will a national care service help your members, particularly those members who are struggling now to run care homes?
So I would say I'd go back to the twin track approach. The National Care Service isn't in and of itself going to deal with the now. It's clearly some way down the line. So we do need quick action now to deal with the fact. And it was interesting to me listening to one of your previous witnesses, the comment that ethical commissioning was much more expensive. Ethical commissioning is perhaps expensive because it reflects the true cost of care, which goes back to the point that was being made. So we're either making a contract through our social care service with the people of Scotland to meet the needs that they have, and we have to be honest about some of the costs involved in that, or you end up with a non-ethical commissioning process which basically tries to drive the price down for those of us, from my members in the not-for-profit sector, who are trying to deliver care, whether that's in a care home or care at home or a mental health service or any other type of service that's there to try to make sure that people are living the best possible lives, are able to engage with their community and have their rights met. So at the moment, I'm going to go back to the point that ethical commissioning we could do more of now. Maybe ethical commissioning is a bit like Leveson for the social care sector. You know, while it's optional, it's often not happening. So one of the things that is interesting to me is, could a national care service actually lever some of the things that by choice are not happening now? Could it take away some of the risk aversion for those who are responsible for procuring? But also, how could a national care service, and it currently doesn't do this, but allow us to have an honest conversation about the quantum of funding available for social care and how that flows through the system as efficiently and with at least waste as possible, so that decisions made at the front line, going back to your own SDS report, for the sorts of care people need and require, can be met. So I think if we could have got, and maybe we still can get, legislation right, we could do that. In the meantime, we can't wait. In the meantime, there are things that could be done that are not being done to think creatively about how to make sure that we're buying in the sorts of care that people need in a fair and equitable way, so that we're not having the last time we took a temperature check on this, you know, we're somewhere between 17 and 20% adrift in pay between local government, who will pay their own staff a great deal more than those that they contract from third sector providers. And I don't even sometimes like the third sector label, because it makes it almost sound like that's okay to do because we're in the third rung. We are not. We are joint partners. A third of social care is delivered by the voluntary sector in this country. And either we're seen as joint partners, or we are really embedding inequity within communities by underpaying a workforce, mostly women, less than they would get to do in the public sector. So there are things we can do now. We can actually genuinely start to embed fair work. We can get ourselves a timetable to get to equity. But sometimes I think there is the potential in this legislation to have, for example, a national care board like Feely was suggesting, which is a board of all of those with a stake. Not a joint accountability agreement, but a genuine joint board able to drive innovation, improvement, ideas for standards. Not a board at the moment which is really setting out a small number of members on the face of the legislation and has codified within the bill something which sounds much more punitive than I think even government are looking for at this stage. So I think there are things we could do. And there are things we could do for the future in this bill if we could get it right. And there are things that we have to do now. And the issue of equity between those who contract themselves in the public sector and everybody else we've got to deal with, which is why I think the joint accountability agreement in and of itself is flawed.
So are you saying, like Cosler was saying, that they're not being listened to? Because you've come up with so many ideas there. Mm-hmm. It feels strange to me that so late in the day you're coming up with these ideas. Have you come up with the ideas and they've just not been listened to? Or if you put forward suggestions and ideas, would you expect those to be listened to?
I would hope they would be. Going back to December 22, for those of you who were around the committee in December 22, when we had the original bill, we produced at that point a document suggesting there were areas we thought could be strengthened. Then everything went very silent for some time while the joint accountability agreement, it turned out, in the background was being negotiated. And from that point on, if I'm honest, that's been the real game in town. So whilst we were major proponents of an expert legislative advisory group, because we always thought it was odd there was no formal bill group, if you like, as you would in every other bill I've ever been involved in 20 years of working with this parliament, the expert legislative advisory group didn't really give us the space to go in with ideas. It was very much, here's a proposal, what do you think? You've got a day to respond or 2 days to respond. And actually, going back to Karen's point about ethical commissioning, which for us is a fundamental in this, this is where we could make a real change to the members of my organisation. We got some papers in the expert legislative advisory group that led us to think that what was in the bill was going to be much more radical than it is. And in fact, it doesn't feel like a radical move. So we have lots of ideas. I will be honest, we're meeting with officials from government on Thursday to start sharing some of those. Perhaps the one potential good thing of the last week, which you'll appreciate, we, like you, are also trying to get our heads around. It's only just been over a week since the withdrawal, is maybe there is more space for us to be listened to. Mm-hmm. And actually, if that happens, great. We've got ideas, as will many of our partners in this sector. People are full of ideas. We know what needs to change.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. My questions are around accountability functions of the National Care Service Board. What do you understand as the purpose of a National Care Board, and to what extent could it or should it contribute to a fundamental reform of a social care landscape?
I think it should and could do exactly what I've just been suggesting. So if we had a National Care Board, for example, which, unlike the National Social Work Agency, which is focused on social work, a really important but very tiny part of the overall workforce market that we need, if we had a National Care Board that was genuinely driving a strategy for the future of our social care workforce, how are we growing our talent? How are we making sure that we are supporting and training sufficiently enough people to go in and meet the sorts of needs? We've been talking around these chambers for 20 years. We know what our demographic looks like, and yet we have no strategy to deal with that. If you had a National Care Board that could be, for example, with something like ethical commissioning, could be setting clear standards of what was being expected and monitoring that. If they were working with Audit Scotland, the Care Inspectorate and others to give us a really clear overview. But if they were allowed, permitted, given the powers to really drive the sorts of change that we think we need to see, then I think you'd have a very different sort of National Care Board than the one in the bill. And certainly it shouldn't be a triumvirate between the public sector providers in a shared accountability agreement. I think it should be there to really provide that drive and oversight from all of us. And I'm not just talking about not-for-profit providers here. I'm obviously here to represent my members. From everybody who has a genuine stake in making a National Care Service work for the public of Scotland.
Anybody else?
I think we support the creation of the National Care Service Board. I think there's a lot that change about it. So firstly, around membership, we're particularly concerned that as proposed, the third sector isn't to be represented, and it's not entirely clear why. Fully support the. And really welcome the inclusion of sort of lived experience with voting rights. That's a big step forward from sort of IJBs currently. But we think that the sector should be represented as a sort of major provider. And I think that would go towards as sort of Rachel was describing, having everybody round the table with an equal voice. In terms of its role and functions, a lot of what's being proposed is itself a focus on sort of oversight of sort of local boards, and while scrutiny is important, there's the element of basically marking the local board's homework, and there's the gaps around things that you could do around national consistency, improvement support, monitoring progress, setting national standards, the sort of monitoring unmet needs, and supporting the sharing of learning and good practice and ideas across the country. So we'd want to see the sort of the role amended to reflect that, to allow it to go some way to what I think Feely described as a sort of unwarranted local variation, and addressing some of the issues that exist to drive up the quality of social care across the country.
Thank you. So I think what those who have spoken before have said, I completely agree with everything that they have both said. I would add also about the role of the board in raising the profile of the sector, and that shape piece about sharing good practice. And I think that in order to make it work, there's some real learning to be had from the review of progress with integration reports, and of course the Associated Audit Scotland report on integration as well. Of course, I couldn't speak to this without saying that at the present, the bill says providers of social care, but it doesn't specify what it means by that word providers. So it could mean local authority provision, but they're only 23% of provision. It's that wider spectrum of provision that needs to be represented there. And as 87% of that being my membership, then I would really hope to see some more greater clarification in that space.
Thank you. Rachel, you touched on this question earlier, but how should the breadth of stakeholder views be represented on a National Care Board to ensure that such a board remains responsive to all those affected by board decisions, including users, service users and providers?
So I would suggest that the first thing is to get the functions of the board right, because then you can get the right people around the table. As providers of social care, two of us here representing providers outside of the public sector, making sure that that voice is there so that the entire system can be designed in a way with funding flowing, with decisions being made that don't have unintended consequences. And I think that is the problem at the moment, that too many decisions are made with unintended consequences because there's a lack of understanding about how the whole system works, which is why I think when people compare the NCS to the NHS, we're talking very different things. Not only is the model different, it's a social, not medical model of approach that I would hope that we would make sure a National Care Service had. But actually, going back to your own SDS report and thinking about what came out from Public Health Scotland a couple of months ago around people's experience of care, very few people know they have a choice. Very few people have really taken forward in the way SDS was meant to be the fact that choice and control should be at the heart of people's experience of social care. And to do that, you need a multiplicity of providers. People need to actually be able to make choices. Otherwise, we're paying lip service to that. That means social care is always going to look different. That means you need to reflect that in the sorts of boards that you have and the way in which a national board could work. One thing just to add, I think, if you wouldn't mind, is that the bit that is missing in the bill at the moment is any sense of how ministers come up with their strategy or how they then fund it. So it would be great if the National Care Board could be taking the data that is out there, the research that is out there, particularly around things like unmet need, and being able to reflect that to ministers so that decisions can be made in the biggest political choice facing this parliament often, which is the allocation of tight resource. And that is, again, a really important function for the National Care Board. And unless providers like mine are around the table, then the sorts of issues I've described today about the issues they face in the contracting situation that they are in will get lost.
Anybody else?
Can I add around about the necessity to extend self-directed support to those who currently live in care homes? It doesn't seem right that piece of legislation doesn't cover everyone who lives in Scotland. In fact, it seems discriminatory.
And no further questions, Camilla?
Thank you. Karen Walken.
Thank you, Convener. I have a question round about the social work advisor and social work agency. I know you've touched on it, and I know we have had written submissions, but just for the record, just how you think that should play out and what advice you would give us in terms of scrutinising that as an idea.
So as I said in the submission that we gave, I mean, setting up a social work agency to some, we have a chief social work advisor currently sitting in government. I guess the relationship between the social work agency and the social work advisor and the National Care Board is a moot one, because I don't think the bill makes that relationship clear. But like I said earlier, you know, for our social work colleagues, they are best placed to describe to you whether they think that the agency as currently set will do what is needed for their profession. What really deeply concerns me is where is the leadership voice for everybody else? There are 50,000 workers who are employed in third sector and social care. Where is the voice for them in this? Where is the workforce strategy going to sit? Who is advising either the National Care Board or ministers or some joint accountability arrangement none of us are quite sure about at the moment? Who's advising them about what's needed for this workforce? And the unbalancing, I think, of that with a National Social Work Agency, and believe me, I'm not suggesting that we retrofit it into something called a National Social Work Agency. The discussions there have clearly been about social work, and they have very much their own needs to deal with. So if the National Care Board doesn't have that role, if there isn't a social care advisor to that role, then my fear is that the imbalance that we already have in social care, for example, in the way in which contracting works, will continue in the way in which the workforce is valued and the way in which the workforce is developed. So whatever happens to the National Social Work Agency, and I'm not the best person to say what that should be, apart from it should be clear with the National Care Board, we have to have that leadership space for the social care workforce as a whole. Too often they are undervalued and forgotten, and that can't happen in a national care service.
Yeah, no, that's a helpful addition to your submission. I don't know, Rob, if you want to come in.
It's one of the few areas of the NCS proposals that we haven't really taken a view on. I think that sort of colleagues in sort of social work would be best placed to sort of comment on how it would affect them. So it's not something we've got a great deal to add.
Okay, thank you. Karen?
And similar, we have also called for either a social care advisor or a professional social care officer in our submission to the bill, for exactly the reasons that Rachel called out. I would also put into place, you know, the feminist dynamic of this as well. Having a largely female workforce, there really is a requirement to raise the profile of people who work in the social care sector in a more formal manner, because we know that it's not working currently. And we know that, you know, very few members of the workforce are currently members of unions, or have other routes to having that voice. But it's not just about the workforce, it's actually also about knowledge and understanding of the complexity of how the social care sector operates and the landscape that it's in. And without anyone with those expertise at the table, that's partly why we're getting, you know, bitty bills and bitty legislation being developed. So it's great to be able to be here today and have an opportunity to speak.
No, that's very helpful. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Kavita.
Thank you. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to hear your reflections on the Charter of Rights. A couple of questions around that. I suppose the first thing is, what level of reassurance does the draft charter provide that people using care and support services are going to be fully supported to lead the independent lives that they're entitled to lead? Rachel.
It's a tricky one, this, and I know we said this in our response. So anything that makes clear to the Scottish public what the rights they have in terms of social care seems a good thing to do. And having that in a one-stop shop spot where people can be really assured of what's expected also seems like a good thing to do. I go back to what we said when the original bill was published. This is a charter of no rights that conveys no new rights. And now, of course, we don't have a human rights bill expected. And I very much doubt that will come forward before the next election. So given the situation that we're in, we then have a draft, which is sort of good to see. You can see the intent, but it's written before we quite know where the bill is. And that makes it, again, really difficult. So I look at two sets of principles, one in the original bill and one in an amended bill that looks very, very different. The amended bill removes all the principles from the Public Bodies Act and transfers them in, some of them at least, into the NCS bill. And there has to be a really clear line of sight, I think, between the principles that are being described that should be driving every single decision and action of a National Care Service, and then what goes into that charter. And of course, until we've got one, it's really hard to quite see how that translates across. So I can see that having some indication is helpful. But the other thing that I would say is you can have a charter. Indeed, you can have ministers writing a strategy about the National Care Service. But actually, if you can't follow through because the investment is historically too low and doesn't improve, then actually the ability to deliver those rights, it goes back to the implementation gap, which in social care, and I appreciate the financial situation we are in, however, in social care, historically underfunded, desperately trying to catch up, you can only very often enact those rights that are set out when there is the ability to do it with the funding. And my concern still remains in the National Care Service bill is that the risk of that is being held by frontline practitioners, organisations at the frontline, and ultimately people who get care and support who may fail to be able to have their rights realised simply because the bill is not forcing through the issue of increasing investment in a sector historically way too short of cash.
To the complaints aspect of it in a second, but I wonder if I could bring in other panel members on that. Rob?
Yeah, I think there's right, look, the sort of the charter is welcome. I think some bits of it are either sort of placeholder at the moment or sort of without the bill. Some bits will sort of need to be filled in. I think that sort of we welcome the creation of the charter and sort of helping to sort of explain people's rights to them in an accessible way. I think sort of inclusive communication and accessible formats are very important for that. But sort of also crucial is getting a sort of complaint system right and being sort of clearly posting people how if the charter, their rights as described in the charter aren't being met, what they can do about it and how it be put right. So hugely important to that is sort of independent advocacy, independent support and independent advice. So it needs to be backed up by the complaints, the redress and the independent advocacy to support that.
I'll bring you in a second, Karen. I wonder to what extent the draft charter makes it clear the rights that people have versus what they can expect from the National Care Service.
Sorry, I thought that was directed wrong again. Sorry about that. It's an accumulation of principles and rights into one space, which I guess offers some clarity. And it's good to see information included in there because it's not been called out to the same extent in other areas. But the reality is that without changing the landscape that it's implemented in, it's not going to make a difference to people accessing care and support. And I would give the example of Fair Work principles. So, you know, we have a Fair Work Charter. That was put into some contractual arrangements. And I would go so far to say that actually this charter should also be put into contractual arrangements. However, contractual arrangements are currently not reciprocal or balanced and don't follow through. So what we've seen is in some areas the removal of Fair Work principles from contracts, because without a fair commissioning process, the commissioning bodies and the procurement bodies know that they can't afford or fund them. So they are going to be, in effect, words if we don't make the changes. And, you know, I'm working with Birmingham University, with Stirling University, on a piece of work funded by UKRI and the Health Foundation on improving adult care together. And it's specifically looking at what is it needs to happen in that frontline space so that we can, you know, make this stuff work out there in reality. And actually, you know, that points to another area which Fraser of Allender mentioned in their submission, which is the National Care Service Board could extend to look at research in the sector as well. But at the moment, it's currently quite a limited view in that space. So I would add that into my evidence today too.
Okay, thank you. And in terms of a complaints process, do you think there's enough clarity on the bill at the moment in terms of how a complaints process might work for service users and which bodies will be accountable for what decisions?
I think, like having a charter that's meant to make clear rights, which you would hope could then be enacted by a thriving social care system, if it goes wrong or if people are unhappy, they need to be really, really clear. I think a bit for me, like with the National Care Board, where I still cannot in my own head map how it links to organisations like the Care Inspectorate, SSSC, Scotland Excel and others, whatever the bill is trying to put in, it's got to make it so simple. And actually, very often complaints can be dealt with most effectively, quickly, at the point at which things are maybe not working as they should. And we need not to lose that ability to deal with redress quickly and at the point it's happening, whilst also obviously making sure that people can escalate a complaint if they need to. But I think your previous panel were talking about what's already there, which is already quite a lot. So if it's about simplification, fine, but we need much more clarity on how exactly that will work.
I think the inclusion of the complaints section is really important. It doesn't give a great deal of detail. Some of that can be sort of fleshed out in secondary legislation. One of the things we've suggested is that the bill could be amended to sort of make it clear that would include redress routes as well. I think, as described, the current complaints system is messy, and there's a lot of different things will sort of go into the complaints system, whether it's appeals, if you were, against sort of decisions, whether it's that somebody feels they've been discriminated against, or whether it's just kind of queries and sort of service changes. So there's kind of a lot going into a system. So I think there's an opportunity to see whether that can be streamlined and simplified and made easier for people to do so. And also that they've got the sort of the independent advocacy, the independent support that they need to sort of make the complaints and have things put right.
Thank you. So the complaints that land on my desk are the complaints that land in the places in between. So, for instance, where an individual chooses to live in a care home that's not in their local authority area, who pays for that? Who funds that? Now, ordinarily, you know, the care home would manage that for a period of time whilst the statutory bodies had a wee fight about whose responsibility it was. But now we're finding that they're taking up to 2 years to have that fight, by which time, you know, the care home is struggling to have the cash flow to pay their staff. And this is happening increasingly. So that's one example. There are other examples. You know, at the National Care Forum yesterday was an example of access to a piece of equipment for an individual. The complaints and redress does not currently cover that. Now, the National Care Board could do. You know, there could be some responsibility around about what happens in the spaces in between and how do we take that forward and how do we offer clarity in that space. But the complaints and redress, as it currently stands, doesn't.
Are you able to, it's helpful, I think, for us to have a bit of colour in terms of the experience of people? Are you able to expand a bit on that complaint you were talking about in terms of access to equipment?
So again, this is another common one. And during the pandemic, the Scottish Government rewrote what was formerly called the Equipment Protocol. They didn't undertake a proper consultation process and rewrote that paper without provider engagement, without causal engagement, and the responsibility to pay shifted from the NHS to care providers who are not funded to do that.
And can I ask what sort of equipment you're talking about?
Things like
that impact?
Specialist chairs, specialist beds, things that prevent pressure sores, things that enable people to walk, to move, but the funding's not flowing through the system. And of course, the implications for those, you know, for human beings are huge. Their ability to live life with dignity. And, you know, some are suffering physical consequences as a result. The example at the forum yesterday was someone getting pressure sores because of that. So these are the sort of bits, because it's fallen in between gaps and it's not being dealt with. It's been passed round and round. That's what the complaints and redress system needs to work at. Other than that, it's very much about that local intervention and that local space. How do we make it right?
Okay. Thank you. That's helpful.
Thanks. Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel so far. Just want to turn to commissioning, tendering and procurement. There's been significant concerns expressed in written correspondence with the committee in relation to ethical commissioning. Do you believe that ethical commissioning should be referred to and defined on the face of the bill, and why?
I had a long discussion about this with my members yesterday, and we've been considering the response given to the question that you'd raised on this back in September, and we've been struggling to actually understand what the response means, particularly on the words ethical considerations, which I don't even know what an ethical consideration is. We were really disappointed to see every reference to ethical commissioning and procurement lost from the bill. We still can't really understand why, given that this is a key facet of what FEALI was meant to deliver. Services that are funded without price-based competition seems like a fundamental shift that we should be aiming for at the National Care Service. The definition of ethical commissioning was interesting because in the original bill, obviously still on the table, it talks about applying the principles. And I think some of the principles themselves, obviously, I think many of them have now changed. So it's trying to work out whether that might still be a way forward to think about how ethical commissioning could be delivered. Somebody mentioned fair work earlier. The change to the fair work principle, it leaves us with significant consternation because it now puts the fair work principle on the employers, though it's still not clear, as colleagues have said, which employers are in the National Care Service and which are not. But if that were to include contracted employers and the principle were to apply, even though we know fair work in social care has not been delivered through contracts, then actually it's putting the responsibility in entirely the wrong place. The National Care Service should, through all of its work, be responsible for delivering fair work with equity across the system. So we're looking at the moment in terms of our thinking about talking to government and other parties about amendments, whether it would be possible to look at the principles and think whether we could reinsert some of what was in the original bill around applying the principles. But it also then comes down to the procurement provisions within the bill, which, as I said earlier, we don't think go far enough. We're not quite sure how they would work. So particularly in terms of the reservation, which we would have a different view from our colleagues at Scottish Care, but actually the 5-year contract and the 3-year rule for not applying we think isn't actually workable. We're not quite sure how that would work within a local authority area where many big providers will have multiple contracts. Our understanding was a similar provision had been rejected by the Scottish Government previously. So we have provided some ideas to Scottish Government, which we're talking to them on Thursday, to try and work through whether some alternative ideas to the procurement regulations within, or the procurement provisions within the primary legislation, could actually be significantly strengthened to support ethical commissioning in practice. And I guess we could tie ourselves in not trying to come up with a perfect articulation of ethical commissioning, or we could actually have a bill that does it, that gives the levers to what we think it should be, and we think about how the principles could better reflect what ethical commissioning should be for the people at the front line who are needing support and those delivering it.
Are you able to elaborate on what you would like to see in terms of how that could be strengthened in the face of the bill?
So our sense is a number of things. What we've been working through is at the moment, the way the bill is structured, we've got ministers coming up with a strategy, and then we've got a National Care Board coming up with a plan, and then we feel a little bit like a process of osmosis. Something then has to run through the system down to local care boards. At the moment, we think that should be improved. We think the strategy needs to be stronger. As I said earlier, it needs to be informed by need. It needs to talk about the quantum of funding available. We think there are some potential regulations that have been brought forward in England that might give us an interesting route to think about whether we create specific procurement, a procurement landscape for social care, because it's not buying widgets. It doesn't. Current procurement legislation isn't applied in a way that separates it in local government from everything else they're procuring, whether that's school meals or anything else. And actually, this is quite a specific sector. We think at the moment, and we're publishing work today, actually, from Anne Hendry and Stephen Gibb, that's been looking at whether currently commissioning and procurement is working, which it says it isn't. And so part of that is the gap between IJB's commissioning but local government procuring, and the translation of what's required isn't always helpful. So we've been starting to explore, for example, could the bill make the procurement strategies the responsibilities of IJB, so you keep commissioning and procurement in one place? That would also mean then that you're looking at local government as a provider, as part of a provider market, I don't like the word, but I can't think of a better one, of all of those who are providing social care. So rather than holding the purse strings and paying themselves, there is actually IJBs having a say in how money is distributed among a sustainable group of providers for the local economy. So we think there are a whole range of things that could be done. We do think we were hoping there would be more said around the cap on the light touch regime, which isn't in there, and the current changes to the regulations on the restricting of contracts. We think the wording in there does need some changing. In practice, I can't see how you can be a provider with multiple contracts. It's not clear if it's the contracts across the whole of Scotland, if you're a Scottish-wide provider, in terms of the restrictions of the 5- and 3-year rule.
Do you share this assessment at all?
I can come in briefly on sort of ethical commissioning. I think to sort of basically that we were also sort of concerned that it was the references were removed from the bill, and we'd be keen to see them put back in. I think one of the things that we've on the bill is introduced that it was missing a definition. And that it was important to have a sort of single definition there for sort of clarity, to give it a sort of legal basis, because our concern is that it could lead to it not happening in practice, people having different definitions of sort of ethical commissioning. And so that's something that we'd sort of like to see amended at stage two, is the references brought back and the definitions. But I think others will have more to say than we do on procurement specifically.
Ms. Hedge.
Hi, thank you. So I would be clear that it has to include ethical commissioning and ethical procurement also, that we're only picking up work around about ethical procurement as part of the National Care Service work now is significantly concerning, because, you know, in the last year, 83.9% of care home closures have been independent sector. You know, we've seen 26 care homes close, 19 of those have been voluntary sector. It's just not working out there. The average number of care packages handed back per local authority area in Scotland in 22-23 has been 47. And this is frankly down to poor commissioning and contractual arrangements in those local authority areas that stop providers from able to pass on good terms and conditions and fair work to their employees. So I would have huge concern, actually, about the lack of focus on ethical commissioning as part of the bill, but I would really want to extend it to be ethical commissioning and ethical procurement that's put in there. And it also needs to consider not just how statutory bodies commission, but actually how do we support and enable people to use SDS? Because we talk, I was listening to other people giving evidence who spoke about a failed market. We don't have a failed market. We have a fake market in social care in Scotland. It is not a market. There is one main purchaser of social care and support in Scotland, although that is starting to change as we see the eligibility criteria increase. So we really need to think about how can we shift that up, how can we change that, and some of that's down to the collaborative commissioning arrangements that are happening, you know, in some of the examples that I gave earlier, and I'm thinking also in Midlothian, for instance. So they worked with some of our providers, and one of the key issues that was coming through was actually for our care at home staff, the amount of time that they spend between visits, they weren't getting paid fully amount, or they would have a couple of hours downtime when they didn't have any work to do. So how can they work together to maximise response? And the way that we've seen happen in the Fife Collaborative is happening in Midlothian too. But also, providers worked with the council to be able to offer block contracts to staff. Well, that hugely increased staff retention by 66%, and it also reduced cost to the Health and Social Care Partnership because they weren't then having to spend money on overtime on people from agencies coming in to cover that. So the lack of inclusion of ethical commissioning is taking out the focus and the ability to do that piece of work and to make those changes and to share that in that way that you could do through the National Care Board. Around about the continued inclusion of reserved procurement, I would also suggest that that's in contravention of the SDS Act because it removes choice from the system. So I would be recommending that is taken out of the bill as it currently stands.
And to what extent do you think that the bill's provisions and the proposed amendments from the government offer a more level playing field for providers in terms of tendering? Is that something you see making progress with these amendments?
No, I guess.
Okay.
When the tumbleweed rolled across.
Yes, I figured that was the case. Just also to clarify from your perspective, Ms Cackett, the Age Scotland, for example, has said that they view the current proposals to have led to a market whereby the independent sector dominates because not-for-profit care providers are unable to compete effectively. Is that something you would share a view on?
I think from my perspective, we have providers who are struggling to deliver the sorts of services that they need currently in their local communities. And the fact is we need to make that a lot easier to do, and the money has to flow. One thing I would say on the issue of procurement, procurement's just the end point of a commissioning cycle, and it doesn't have to be formal procurement within regulations. There are also options for things like direct awards that we don't talk about anything like enough. So I think there is an important place for not-for-profit providers in being able to use public funds to reinvest in their workforce and in their community and to make sure that that funding is there and stays in the community. And actually anything we can do to make that easier, to make that fairer in terms of the differential between local government terms and conditions for their own contracting of their own services, and it's not just about pay, it's also about all other uplifts, and the work of organisations like those in my membership, then we have to find a way to do it. I don't think the bill's quite got us there, but we're really up for working to try and strengthen that.
Just in general, is there any other changes to the bill that could help facilitate more innovative and collaborative commissioning?
Good question. If you let me have a think, I'll respond to in writing, if that's okay.
That's fine, yeah. Is there any other immediate views on that?
So I think, as I said, we've provided to the government some examples from down south, dare I say,
sure.
But I think that could actually give us some helpful models. But I do think if we're going to have a national care service that goes from ministers and down and back up again, in fact, it should be the other way around, it should be from the front line to ministers and back down again, then actually we need to make sure the full commissioning and procurement cycle is there. One of the things in terms of national procurement, which we haven't really touched on in this evidence session, is the role of Scotland Excel and the way in which a national care board could be commissioning national services. I know the Minister's talked about, particularly for complex care, by which I assume we're talking about things like the Coming Home Report. I do think with Scotland Excel, which is a governance structure which is entirely set within local government, and I heard your previous panel talking about Scotland Excel, we think there's a real conflict of interest with a National Care Board and Scotland Excel and its current governance arrangements directing national procurement for a National Care Board. We're doing a lot of work with Scotland Excel at the moment to try to improve the way in which Scotland Excel and providers are working together, but we have significant concerns. The care and support framework being one of them, which was negotiated very late, which is resulting in a negotiating position that is going to result in lower costs going to our members than we'd have liked, largely because local councils were refusing higher uplifts. There will be no backdating of non-workforce cost uplifts for the first 6 months of the year, even though it was late coming. And we're hearing more of councils now withdrawing from that framework because they can't afford it, or HSCPs, I should say, more accurately. So we've got a situation at the moment where even where we're meant to be negotiating a national framework to try and cut down on bureaucracy, to try and give us greater stability and consistency across the country, actually individual HSCPs and councils are withdrawing from that. So we have to be able to understand within the bill how to innovatively do the national commissioning. And whilst I agree on the whole that Once for Scotland is not the way forward for all of social care, there will be things where it is, and the bill perhaps needs to be a bit clearer on that.
You're very brief.
Okay. Just a note, in your written submission, you mentioned 83% of respondents to your survey of not-for-profit providers said they were providing a public service despite a deficit budget. That seems unsustainable to me. How would you address that?
It is unsustainable. Similarly, in the same survey, we had many, I'm trying to think of the figure was around 60%, but I can come back to the committee with the figures exactly, of providers at the end of the last financial year, at the end of the winter, who were talking about contract handbacks or reducing service. It's not sustainable. That's our problem, which is why we always wanted to see a really effective national care service. And also, we can't wait. I'm hearing more and more from the chief executives in my organisations of the untenable pressure that they are now under to find mid-year savings in budgets that were already too low. We've got a recruitment crisis because we're not paying people. We keep talking about fair work but not doing it. And actually, it is simply unsustainable.
OK, thank you very much.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thanks for your answers so far. If I could come to Rob for this first question. We've heard a lot in panels over this evidence taking that there's a lot of the bill that could be progressed out with the legislation. As someone representing an organisation who represents disabled people and people with lived experience, why do you think it is so important that some of these things in the bill are in legislation?
I think probably the biggest reason would be that some of the things have been possible outside of legislation, but they haven't happened, and it's been quite a long time, and it hasn't progressed. So I think it gives some of the impetus to do that in terms of the kind of prioritisation of statutory services. It's also really important in terms of taking a human rights-based approach, that legality is a key element of that, and being clear about people's rights in law. I think particularly thinking of the kind of the independent advocacy is a great example in there, that it could be funded and provided, but giving people a right to independent advocacy sort of really strengthens its role. There's a guarantee that it would be provided for people who need it to access services. So I think probably that's that would be key. There is lots of other things sort of outside of it, so removing social care charges, implementation of SDS, removing eligibility criteria, workforce pay and conditions that could be done without legislation. But I think it's important that there are things that would sort of need legislation to happen, or where it's really important in sort of driving them forward towards a human rights based approach.
And of those things that mm-hmm. need to go into legislation to give that life to it, as you've articulated, which of those do you believe need further amendment to strengthen them, and what would you propose for those?
I think in terms of sort of independent advocacy, we would be into see a definition of independent advocacy. That's important because sometimes sort of advocacy is provided, but it's not genuinely independent. Mm-hmm. There's also things that could be done that referred to in the sort of call for views that we sort of work with the Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance on. I've mentioned sort of the complaints that there would be to that sort of a of sort of redress would be important as part of that, and some wider things in terms of the kind of the effect of the National Care Service principles. I think that would be something that could be strengthened.
That's great, thanks. And if I could then come to Karen and Rachel on my next question. We've heard from care home relatives that there has been a delay in the implementation of Anne's Law, and that care home relatives are maybe not seeing what they would like to have seen in terms of progression of that issue. What do you perceive the issues to be with implementing that? And do you believe that this needs to be on a statutory footing, even though it could be progressed out with the bill, to give those families that certainty that actually we won't see what happened before happen again?
Can I suggest that perhaps Karen is best to answer on this one?
So in conversation with Care Home Relative Scotland, the bill as it currently stands doesn't change where the power sits, so there is still a possibility that a decision could be made by government through public health bodies that would prevent access to care homes by individuals. And fundamentally, that's because that doesn't change the reality that they're currently facing, then they don't see what's contained, well, what's not in the bill anymore, but what was sitting alongside the bill and what was in the first iteration of the bill to be the solution for them. What we need to do is to think about actually that fundamental piece that people living in a care home, it is their home. And how do we balance their right to have a family life at the same time as that balance to a right to safety? So, you know, we need to be able to work with the people who run our care homes, those who have expertise of doing that, that can bring in their expertise of infection prevention control in a rights-based setting. So they have that expertise. During the pandemic, we experienced health practitioners coming into care homes who didn't have that expertise. They were bringing ward-like measures into a care home, which doesn't operate like a ward. So how do we put the people back into that setting? And that's the big question that we have. So we need to fundamentally make this a rights-based choice for people living in care homes. But we also need to recognise, you know, the skill set that already exists with those people working in social care, so that if there's a situation where guidance needs to be developed, then they are included in the development of that guidance. And it's done and created through that lens of human rights and that right to family life.
I think we need to be clear that it hasn't come out of the bill yet. The bill is as still published at stage one. We have passed no amendments. So it's before we set hairs running with relatives. Do you believe it should remain in the bill, or is your position that it should be delivered elsewhere?
So, I'm a great believer that there's no point in making legislation for things that should happen anyway, so I'm not sure what difference this makes. However, I fundamentally believe that we need to have that connection in place in a way that is balanced for care providers, and that they're able to do that in a way that makes it safe for their staff as well. So I think that it needs to stay in, but we need to be able to get the finer detail of this and that bit around about where does power lie. Again, it needs to sit within the system, within the people that are in those care homes, the people who live there, their families, the people that work there, and, you know, not be able to be undermined by people who don't have the expertise in that system.
OK, thanks, Camilla.
Thank you. Can I thank the panel for their evidence this morning, and we'll suspend briefly to change witnesses. We continue our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill with a third panel of witnesses. And a welcome to the committee, Fiona Colley, Head of Public Affairs and Communications, Carer Scotland, Dr Jim Elder Woodward, OBE, Co-Convener of Inclusion Scotland, Frank McKillop, Director of Governance and Policy, Enable Scotland, and Adam Staruccia, Associate Director for Policy, Communications and External Affairs from Age Scotland. And Jim is supported by a representative from Inclusion Scotland. So welcome to the panel. And we're going to move straight to questions and Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you all. It is still morning, actually. We've got proposed amendments to this National Care Service Bill in front of us. So I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on the proposed amendments. Specifically, one of our briefing papers has questions around transferring accountability for the proposed National Care Service to Scottish ministers, as that was what was originally or initially proposed. And then is that necessary to deliver the recommendations of the Derek Feely's review? Adam?
To start, I think the a responsibility of Scottish Government and Scottish Government Ministers is absolutely essential to a care service in Scotland that is in desperate need of reform. I think from the Feely review work, some of the core principles that Age Scotland had was about actually having proper accountability, proper responsibility, and from that breeds better resourcing and actually, I think, better national standards for care. So I think having Scottish ministers very involved in the delivery of social care is necessary, because the system as it stands without that isn't working particularly well at all.
Okay. Fiona?
Yeah. I'll do it, sir. Sorry. I press it myself. I think I'd simply want to echo that. I mean, I think when we've had a number of events with carers and when there's been discussion about things that aren't working well, it's the difficulty of knowing who's responsible. And in many cases, it isn't Scottish ministers, and so there's no there's less impetus to make changes and less cooperation in relation to making changes. So I think it's a positive move forward to bring that accountability to Scottish ministers, alongside that shared accountability with COSLA and local authorities, because I think we are in a position, and the review was very, very clear, that social care, as it is not working for individuals and their carers.
And I know, well, actually, I'm not sure, Frank, were you gesturing to speak?
Just on that point, I think it's certainly our view at Enable, our frustration, I think, going back to the implementation of the Self-Directed Support Act from 2013, we've had over a decade of the current arrangements, and the experience for far too many disabled people across Scotland has been that they are not getting access to the self-directed support they are supposed to have a right to. So I think our view is certainly there has to be something done to shake up that level of accountability. Who do people with a disability and their families go to when they are not getting their right to self-directed support? And it's certainly our view, we've always supported the idea that there would be accountability resting with Scottish ministers and a clear line from which people with a disability and their families can go to in order to ensure that the rights they are supposed to already have from existing legislation are actually upheld.
Okay, thanks. Not sure if Jim wants to come in, and then I've got one other question.
Yes, I'm representing disabled people's organisations in Scotland, and we were delighted with the original idea of the minister being responsible for the whole of Scotland, because we want the uniformity of service across Scotland. We spent 2 years talking to COSLA about the postcode lottery system where local authorities, people have to be reassessed by a new authority when they move from one area to another. We want you to use the property. We want you the same level of service provision. Now that we've got the Verity House Agreement, where services are going to be local by default, national by agreement, we feel that as building a coach and horse through the whole process of the National Care Service. I hope you can understand what I'm saying.
I think so. I think I've got the gist of your responses. Everybody's in agreement that we need accountability, we need ministerial accountability, and to help drive the
another
direction.
Another point I would like to make is that this Verity House Agreement, where we have the tripartite overall of the National Care Service, that I cannot see that in the bill. And if it's not in the bill, we really need to know how it's going to operate and whether the National Care Service is going to be a legitimate authority or whether it's going to be this tripartite overlord who makes the final decision. We are unhappy about that situation.
Okay. You're all members of the expert legislative advisory group. But I'd be interested to hear how the experience of working together in order to shape potential proposed amendments, how has that been for you?
I felt I was being led by the nose to the whole process by the government, and I couldn't see many of the suggestions we made in the ELAC in the final report. We were led by the nose by the Scottish government civil servants. It was not a good thing process. I don't know if my colleagues would agree with that.
I think the idea behind it, I know it came from the committee, I think that was fairly sound, to have a whole load of people who might have something interesting beyond the government's own thinking, some degree of co-production, I suppose. The execution of it, however, I think was really poor, if I'm really honest. I think there was a huge number of people who gave up a lot of time to do reading, to contribute, and actually the mechanism for doing that was incredibly difficult. I'm not entirely sure any member of the ELAG group feels it was a good experience, particularly if you're looking at amendments. Well, there was no sight of what amendments were, potential amendments, or work around that. And the end product of, and I think it was a poorly written letter, which suggested that members of the expert legislative advisory group were sort of supportive of all these amendments was wrong. And when it was stipulated that we're there to kind of advise to some degree and you couldn't possibly get consensus from every single person, every single element of it, particularly when they weren't really visible to you at all. I know that colleagues at H. Scotland also took part in this as well, and the feeling was mutual. So it's pretty hard to measure what impact that time effort had, and even trying to go through a marked up bill to try and understand with some kind of professional hat on what has changed and how it's really difficult indeed. I don't think it worked as well as maybe the intention was. But I don't have any solution to how it worked any better, to be honest.
Thanks.
Sandesh Kohani.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. And a question of interest as a practising NHS GP. Can I start with you, Dr. Jim? In your submission, you said the promise for childcare is a waste of paper and has meaningless words. And we heard from our previous panel that children's services are in crisis. Given where we are right now with the bill and the fact that £28 million has been spent on it, do you feel that this bill is absolutely necessary, or could we start making changes already, especially in children's services?
The Cobrandon report, if you remember, back in the 1960s, recommended that children's departments, the welfare department and probation became one organisation, which is a social work department. And I probably agree that that was a good suggestion, that we look at the family as one unit rather than different social workers going to the same family. However, you have to remember that childcare is written in legislation as being a duty on local authorities, whereas adult care as a power. The local authority in legislation has given the power to help adults, but they have a duty to care for adults, for children. Therefore, more money, more emphasis has historically been given to childcare rather than adult care. Adult care has historically been the Cinderella service in social care. So I welcomed the government's original idea of making the National Care Service an adult care service, to which childcare can be added to at a later date. But I do think we need to pour more attention onto adult care first, because that has historically been the Cinderella service in social work. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, thank you. And my final question, if I could ask the rest of the panel, given that COSLA has withdrawn its support, given that the unions, including the SUC, just yesterday, have withdrawn their support for the bill, where do you think that leaves the bill? And if we push forward with the bill as it is, with no shared accountability, seemingly, what do you think is going to happen?
I'm quite happy to come in there. I think it's difficult, and I think you're probably all grappling with this as well. But what is really clear is the issues that the pandemic uncovered, and the independent review of adult social care addressed are long-standing. There are issues that disabled people and paid carers have been dealing with for years, if not decades. And it feels like there are things within the bill that could continue. There are things within the bill around sharing accountability and about national accountability. But critically, that the funding for social care is increased, and there is a, I think that the point that Jim made about duties and support for people, I think it's potentially for an opportunity to be lost. We've been very clear, and carers have been very clear that we were concerned that the goodwill and the good elements and the things that we wanted to achieve to improve people's lives and to help them flourish could be brought forward as part of the National Care Service, but there is actually nothing to stop government and local government pushing forward now and improving social care for individuals. And we feared that it might get lost in arguments about structural change. But I think what the important thing for all parties is to remember the people who are at the heart of it, which are disabled people, older people and unpaid carers, and the support that they will need now and in the future, and how we plan and support that.
Yeah, I think from Enable's perspective, we very strongly supported the recommendations of Derek Feely's independent review of adult social care. We looked forward to a National Care Service being introduced, which would implement a lot of those. And I think it is undeniable that much of what we thought we would get is not there anymore. And very aware of the negotiations and difficulties that have been in getting to there. I think what we have nevertheless always felt right from day one of this is that the process of establishing a National Care Service, the process of forwarding new legislation, cannot be a substitute for the immediate action that is essential in social care right now. We have an ongoing recruitment and retention crisis. We have a workforce that is not paid at the level that they should be through government funding coming to commissioners, and we need to act upon that immediately. Measures like collective bargaining for the social care sector could be implemented pretty much immediately. That doesn't need legislation. Even a substitute for that of tracking social care pay funding for commissioners to the NHS Agenda for Change scale is a change that could be implemented immediately if there was the political will to put the funding behind that. And again, we have just seen almost £450 million being put up to ensure that the NHS pay is increased by 5.5%, which we absolutely support. But it is the frustration we always have in social care, is that we are probably at the back of the queue for those pay uplifts in the public sector coming through to third sector providers as well. So I think there are measures that can be taken immediately. The Coming Home report was published way back in 2018. The implementation report came out 3 years after that, and yet we still have hundreds of people in inappropriate institutional placements in Scotland. We know what we need to do to support people into their own homes and the communities, and we don't need the bill to make that happen. So we've always supported the principle of a National Care Service. We would like to see something like what Derek Feely had recommended coming to pass, but we absolutely need that urgent action on those measures in terms of paying conditions for the frontline workforce and supporting people into their own homes and the communities who are currently stuck in hospitals and institutions. We need to move on that now, and we can do that without the legislation.
I think the legislation is really important. I think it's obviously frustrating that key partners in delivering this, whether it's COSLA or unions, are not supporting it anymore. But I think it's an incumbent on the government and them to get back on the table and to be talking about this. Because what we'll have at the end of this, if the bill doesn't progress, the bill isn't amended, the bill isn't made as good as it can possibly be, which is really the sort of the ability of the Parliament to help shape that, then we're going to go 4 or 5 steps back in the delivery of social care. There's a lot of stuff that can happen to fix social care now, but that's not really happening just now. All the focus has been on a National Care Service. I think the two things can happen. We can improve social care and have a better model for the future that is, you know, is nationally accountable. I think the frustration then perhaps of COSLA as well is that, you know, with Verity House agreement, that almost out of nowhere at one point there was a brand new arrangement about how social care is going to be, could be delivered, and then there is a withdrawal. Now, if you look at the detail of it, there was a bit of a split vote to some degree. I think there's opportunity to come back and look at what the challenges are, and I think that's on COSLA, local government, and the Scottish Government to do that. But like, there's people right now that are, I mean, hundreds of people in Scotland last year died before receiving any social care package. Who's responsible for that? Who's accountable for that? Genuinely, As one in six older adults in Scotland receive a social care package just now. If that proportion remains in the future, then we're going to have more and more people receiving that. We need to reform it, and reform is difficult. Not everyone's going to like it. Not saying it's perfect as it is, but it's absolutely essential because the system doesn't work. And the fact that we've got thousands upon thousands of people waiting months and months and months to receive a social care package in the first place, by the time they get it, their needs are much more severe, demonstrates it doesn't work. That in March that we had people having reassessed social care packages by local authorities because they were faced a black hole budget black hole and found themselves having their social care packages downgraded. They were not Lazarus. They did not get any better. And yet there is no accountability. Almost overnight, their packages are gone from critical to substantial, and then being told we're only delivering packages for those with critical or palliative needs. How on earth is that right? I think we need to fix this. The bill is absolutely vital, and it can be better. There can be more detail, of course, but I think everybody has to think about what more they can do to deliver good quality social care, because it's not just now, despite all the efforts. We don't have enough people, we don't have enough resource, we don't have enough accountability and national standards. And I'm yet to have a really good reason why local needs are any different. I heard of someone yesterday at the National Care Service Forum talking about they live in East Ayrshire, but it's what they would get just 5 miles away in South Ayrshire is very different. What is the local need difference there? It's been hard to identify. I'm sure there are, but we're facing a position now. The National Care Service had quite a lot of bad PR for a couple of years, and people are leaving it. It adds to the bad PR. The Scottish Government maybe got more responsibility to be talking up this, to have more of a positive, not a spin on it, but talking up the positives of a National Care Service, and that's been missing too. So as a country, we can work out what this is going to be in the future. And I don't think it's about centralisation. It's about just having better national standards and accountability, and we'll come with that, hopefully, resourcing. We're really frustrated by this, because we've been talking about Age Scotland and other charities for years and years and years. We need to reform social care. The National Care Service is, right now, to some degree, is the vehicle to do that. There is not a single other vehicle on the road to help deliver that just now. And I think it's on this Parliament and the Scottish Government and all the care partners involved in the social care services to make that better and come to the table with an open mind about reform. But it's going to be really, really hard. And I don't underestimate the concerns that they have, because we've got lots of concerns about the bill as it stands in front of us because there's a lack of detail. But we're not necessarily the ones who will know how that is fixed, that clarity. But I think there's a lot more we can be doing. So I think it's defeatist to think that this is it, because it can't be. Otherwise, we'll go back 10 years. We won't have reform of social care because the political impetus will disappear to do that. And we'll have to wait for another pandemic for people to care, and that's not palatable at all.
Thank you.
Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My question is to Dr. Elder Woodward. So, Dr. Elder Woodward, you say that you make references to King Lear and those people working in social care that have to cope with the bide and pelting of a pitiless storm. And you also say that the current system is like King Lear, broken and unjust. In relation to the National Care Service, it could have been an opportunity to reassess the role of the councils. That was your opinion. Could you just elaborate upon that and how, if the Scottish Government were to go back to the drawing board, particularly bearing in mind COSLA have pulled their support and the STUC, how the role of the councils might help move things forwards or the restructuring with it?
That's a difficult question to answer, because there needs to be a realisation within COSLA that over the last 25 years of social care austerity, they have harmed and caused misery to many, many people in their locality because of the way they operate the eligibility criteria and the way in which they provide services. They look upon us as service users, as objects of their care, not subjects of their care. And the sooner they realise that we are able and capable of managing our own support services, giving the appropriate resources, not just in money, but in support, the management of our support services, the sooner we can get a human social care service. I use the example of Leah, because Leah's attitude to those around him was totally changed by his own experience of being exiled into the wilderness. He was not feeling the cold and the misery of having to live in a cold environment. Because I have not woken up to feel the cold. There's not been a power grab over our lives as service users. And I feel really grubby when thinking that all we think about is power, not the quality of my life. And I believe that if we did have an national care service with a uniform service delivery and a more proactive policy of helping people from the outset of their need rather than the end of the need. I think we need to have this service the sooner the better.
Thank you. So what you're saying is we've forgotten COSLA and everybody's forgotten that the people element here, it's not the service users, that we almost need to have a complete paradigm shift, go back to Feely, go back to the people who are receiving the care and build up from that rather than this, as you say, power grab.
Yes, exactly. I was fortunate and honoured to be part of the feeling report. And we had real in-depth discussions about what social care meant to people.
Thank you.
And if I can remind people of a Clement Attlee, who wrote a book in 1920, and it's called The Social Worker. This is back in 1920. He says that social work is not a movement concerned alone with the material of housing and feeding centres. It is the expression of the desire for social justice and freedom and beauty and for the better apportionment of all things that make up a good life. Now that was Attlee writing in 1920. The Feely report tried to mimic that approach before you walk. And that is that everyone in Scotland will get the social care support they need to live their lives as they choose and to be active citizens. We will all work together to promote and ensure human rights, well-being, independent living and equity. Now, I don't see that in the actions of Quadra.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. My questions are around the accountability and functions of a National Care Service Board. What do you understand as the purpose of a National Care Board, and to what extent could it or should it contribute to fundamental reform of a social care landscape?
Have you started, if that's helpful? I think this is where you can actually bring together all the key partners in delivering care. There'll be a mechanism from the Verity House agreement if you're going to have local government, look at health and government together, but also including, you know, lived experience, also including, I think there is an element here for, like, say, third sector voices to be around this, but I think it's a better mechanism for national accountability and another vehicle to help kind of deliver, whether it's the right funding, whether it's about interventions, if there are parts of the country that aren't delivering what's required. It's something that's obviously missing just now. If you've got a variety of IGBs and health and social care partnerships that exist across the country, you've got 30 local authorities, you've got COSLA, you've got a whole range of different people that are involved in care. In the Highlands, you've got the NHS as the lead model here. It's going to be a different layer, but probably a necessary layer to have some degree or much better degree of accountability and responsibility. I might repeat those phrases a lot every time you ask me that. I think that's absolutely core, which is what's missing in social care today. This accountability and responsibility for it. If things go wrong, there is nobody responsible, there's nobody accountable, and there's then no one accountable to deliver what's necessary to make the necessary reforms. I think that's what it could do. I think I'd rather use the word could than will, because you don't really know. Proof's in the pudding, of course. And there's still a lot of detail to be worked and understood by a lot of people.
I think a National Care Service Board is absolutely something that we would support, and I think there is that need for national coordination. I think Adam had alluded earlier to the postcode lottery. You know, if someone's moves house, their needs haven't changed, but their postcode's changed, and why on earth is the level of support that they're entitled to changing as a result of that? And I think if National Care Service Board can maintain those standards and have that level of consistency across Scotland, that would definitely be very welcome. And I think one of the most important elements of the National Care Service Board is around the commissioning of complex care, which remains in the bill, and I think is an important element of the bill, where people have been and able. We have supported several people who had been in hospitals for many, many years, and in one case for decades, and who, through partnership working across local authorities with the NHS and with Enable as a provider and with that individual's family and with every other organisation and stakeholder involved in that, we have been able to support people to live in a home of their own and with their own team supporting them for a number of years, and that included through the pandemic and through many of those challenges. So that is something that can be done. It is difficult. It does involve multiple agencies and all being on the same page and absolutely committed to making this work. But where we have achieved it, it has been very successful. That model that has worked in some of those isolated cases, because as we said, and the National Risk Register had identified around 1,400 people who are either in inappropriate placements or at risk of existing care provision failing. There are too many people who need that support, and a National Care Service Board commissioning at a national level the most complex care, learning from experiences that have worked in other parts of Scotland, I think will make a real difference to the lives of hundreds and hundreds of people who are in those circumstances at the moment. So I think that extended accountability, that central accountability, is definitely positive, but in particular supporting those people who are stuck in hospitals and institutions where they shouldn't be. We need that to happen. We need it urgently, and if a National Care Service Board is the way to achieve that, then we would definitely support that.
How should the views of a wide range of providers be represented, not only in the terms of issues relevant to them, but also in the terms of providing solutions, innovation and intelligence on provision?
I wonder if I can come in on that. I mean, I think when we look at the proposals around a national care board and the involvement of people with lived experience and unpaid carers, we feel strongly that is absolutely the case, and it should be have parity of esteem and equity. But I think behind that, it can't be tokenistic, and we need to think how involvement of individuals, be that carers or people with disabilities or older people, are adequately supported. I think with the best will in the world, one carer cannot represent the views of all carers across Scotland. And I think we need consideration of about how that's resourced, how that's supported in terms of gathering the views of other carers, but also thinking about some of the challenges that carers have had in being representative on integrated joint boards. And I have not necessarily had the resourcing that they needed. Some boards have gaps where carers are not involved, and others where carers are looking to stand down because the role in itself is very can be very onerous. I think that there is perhaps something about looking at the equity on any national care board. And that the weighting of people with lived experience and unpaid carers is not one, but a number of people involved, so that they can more readily describe the support that is required and the changes that are required as part of the National Care Board.
Anybody else? Yes.
I am fearful of the idea that one individual can represent all hosts of ages and people. I'm specifically impaired. I know what it's like to be in a wheelchair. I know what it's like to have a speech impairment, but I don't know what it's like to be mentally ill, or to be blind, or to be deaf. So how could one individual represent the whole government of the service users? They can't. That's why I made a suggestion that the representative be accountable to a subcommittee of the board consisting of people from a range of service users so that they can talk to the subcommittee about the agenda items before they go into the board to represent them. There needs to be some structure as well as resources to allow the individual on the board to be effective. Otherwise, it will just be a token. And other professional people with much more power behind them and much more of a structure of powerful people, they will rule the nest. They will run the board. And they did the lived experience participant will just be a nodding head. And that's what I fear from this legislation. The person needs to be supported.
have no further questions, Camilla.
Thank you. Emma Harper, is a supplementary?
Is a just a wee quick sup about how Sweden have a senior alert programme, which is part of assessment and prevention for falls assessment, malnutrition assessment, pressure ulcer assessment. But that's kind of before you even get to the point of needing care, or whether it would be then coordinated through it's a national programme that the government introduced in 2010, 14 years ago in Sweden. And it works, and it shows that it keeps people out of hospital, for instance. And we talk about prevention so that we prevent admission to hospital, but we also want to care for people coming out of hospital as well. So is it something like that might be seen as nanny state if we did that in Scotland, like assessing people when they were 65? But like having a programme where we can help support people to be the healthiest in their homes for as long as possible, or in a care home, which is their home, is that something that you think should be an aspiration for the National Care Service, so that prevention runs alongside care provided?
I think if there was like really good integration in our services, then that kind of thing should be happening. And it's to a degree, I don't mean it essentially like an arbitrary age and all of a sudden you are going to some kind of full medical assessment. But I think this is part of the relationship which maybe GPs or other kind of medical professionals might have about being able to have that discussion with people throughout their life. You could have sort of frailty a lot younger than that. Of course, you can have dementia a lot younger than 65. Mm-hmm. I think this is what's really important. I was speaking at the British Geriatric Society conference on Friday, and I think there should be more geriatricians, you know, and embedded in the community. And really thinking about how you can... Social care is so important for prevention as well, like how these things link together properly. So it's a very good question. And I think if you had a system that was integrated, that different parts of the system were talking to each other, that were picking up a can-do attitude, well, this thing might be required, who can help deliver that? I think for some people going into later life, a tiny bit of care will be what they need for a very, very long time. But going without it for a very, very long time means that intervention that they receive is either medical or critical care needs, that they're just not going without what they need to help them live their lives in whatever way that might be. And there'll be people who are disabled a lot younger in life, who become older and their needs change massively. So I think there's a lot in that. But I think if you've had a care service and a health and care service that was properly integrated despite all the rhetoric, then these types of things could be happening. And there will be good practice in Scotland of these types of things, but the point then is that it's disparate. There isn't proper collaboration, there isn't proper shared learning, and I'm sure for those from the table that are medically trained and GPs and clinicians, you'll know what good practice looks like, but it's maybe not being shared as widely. There's a lot more we can do in prevention. I think there's a lot more we can do in prevention of health for older people, but we're not doing enough of that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Okay. Thank you. I'm interested. I know that not everyone or every organisation has taken a position on this, but I'm interested to know if anyone has any views they'd like to put on the record about the National Social Work Advisor and the National Social Work Agency, whether you believe it is necessary or would benefit in terms of its provision within the bill. You look at him as if you're going to say something.
Sorry, I don't mean to get in the way of everyone else if there was something better. I mean, like we said in our response, we tend to support that. I don't have a huge amount of experience in that, but the more we've kind of learned, the more it gets talked about, you can kind of understand, I think, why that could be helpful, particularly how it might fit in with a national care service. Indeed, there's kind of, you know, having some kind of consistency of standards, having where government can have a role in this. I think there's a lot to be welcomed in that idea and that principle. But it's not, our point was we sort of tend to support the notion and the idea, but others will have a far better real life view on how that could work. But I think it's important how it might fit as part of the picture for a national care service and a care board and local care boards and all these types of things, having that kind of standardised route for social work. It's so important because it's such an important discipline, which maybe isn't getting enough of the attention that it needs as well.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. You talk about as it's discussed, it can develop. I don't know if you want to come in.
I've
Quite simply, just to concur with that view, I don't think we have a particularly strong view on the issue at the moment. And I think that there are others probably more qualified in terms of its development and its structure, who I'm sure you've either heard from or will be hearing from.
Yeah, we have, and it's helpful to hear that response in terms of those, you know, that profession, but also the supportiveness as it develops. I don't know, Frank or Dr. Woodward.
Yes, I'm particularly uncertain about what this agency will do. And how will it relate to the other agencies we already have, like the Care Inspectorate or the SSSC? Okay. How do they fit in with a new agency? I think, from my reading, the emphasis is on education and social work education and standards. I think that is important, that somebody ought to be responsible for the oversight of social work education and standards. Whether that should be part of the National Care Service or a different agency, I don't know, but I think education and standards are important. Vis-a-vis education, there's been a long, long argument that educating social workers should include being listening to service users and the involvement of service users in the educational process. That's not happening universally. Okay. It's happening in small institutions, but it's not a policy that we involve the input of the end user in social work. And I think that's important.
Okay. Thank you. I don't know, Frank, if you want to briefly come in. Or...
Yeah, I think sort of following others, again, we're fairly neutral on this question, not being specifically involved in that sector. I'm sure social work professionals and representatives will have views to contribute on that. I think what we found interesting about that element is the idea of workforce planning and workforce strategy. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that we see in the NHS. We've never really seen it specifically done for social care, and often social care, workforce strategy and workforce planning goes hand in hand with NHS. And sometimes there's a bit of a crossover there. There's sometimes a bit of a cannibalisation of the social care workforce by the NHS when there are gaps in the NHS, which obviously just passes the problem from one part of the system to another. So I think that idea of workforce strategy, if that is something that could come out of that element of the bill or that principle, I think is something we would welcome for social care, because as we've said, there is a recruitment and retention crisis in social care that we do need to take specific efforts to address. It's not just as a crutch for the NHS when there's issues in the NHS that we need social care. We do need social care at all times. I think, rather like Emma Harper's question about prevention there, it's investment in social care and social care workforce will make savings for the public purse down the line, and I think we need to have perhaps a bit more sophistication in terms of that workforce strategy and planning.
Okay. Lovely. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to hear your reflections on the Charter of Rights. What level of reassurance does the draft charter provide that people using support services and care services are going to be fully supported in accessing what they're entitled to in terms of independent living? Jim, you're making eye contact, so I'll come to you first.
Right. Some people like the idea of it finally being written down in one place. But that's a good idea. For me personally, I think it's a waste of paper. I think it's a waste of paper. Because within legislation, the self-users of noise. So social work is legislation is written in terms of the duty placed upon local authorities, not the rights of people. And therefore, within social care legislation, we don't have any rights at all. The only right we have is under human rights legislation. And what we find there is that when we take local authorities to court, the court isn't interested in the outcome of a decision. It's only interested in the process of a decision. And this is illustrated in a case, McDonald versus Kensington. McDonald was a Scottish ballerina who contracted MS. And she required help at night to go to the toilet. And in order to cut costs, Kensington withdrew her night support and made her wear pads, nappies, and night. She took Kensington to court, and her initial outcome was she won the case simply because Kensington didn't operate the correct process of reassessing her before deciding. They just decided without a reassessment. So what happened? Kensington reassessed her and assessed her as needing pads. So even in human rights legislation, we have limited power. To support our needs. I hope you understood what I was saying.
I did. Thank you. Thank you. That's helpful. Age Scotland's submission talked about the differences between rights and expectations. Would you expand a bit on that and the importance of that?
Yeah, I think slightly to your first question, having a charter, I think, is an important piece. I think we've seen that with having charters with regard to Social Security as well has been an important step in what Scotland can do. I think if you go back to these principles of, you know, the most important person in the room for this is the person who needs that support, who's reliant on it, and them having something almost to hold to say, well, these are the things, my expectations I should get, but also they're also beyond that. There's an element of how they relate to their rights. And I think if you go back to the big context of human rights and how they're not enacted for a lot of people, that it's helpful for somebody to have, for the state or whoever, to then almost go out their way to demonstrate why you're not going to be able to access them. It makes it pretty difficult, actually. There's a lot in the chart, I think, is to be welcome. There's still placeholders. It'd be great to have more detail. I think the concept of them is really important. I think what people going into this, you know, if you've never experienced social care before, you have no idea what you're to expect. I think from calls to our helpline, a lot of them are people who are calling about, what do I do now? And trying to get an assessment or it's a financial needs assessment or a financial needs assessment. All of these things, you're going from never having any step into the system to needing almost everything, unlike the health service, where you've probably been born at the hand of the health service and had regular kind of interactions with it. So I think this is why the charter is incredibly important, is what your expectations go into and how you can make sure they are embedded rights that you can almost hold to make that point. But these are the things that I need. There's more detail. I'm sure over time such a thing could be enhanced and made more accessible, made more available, and part of that training and development through the whole system, that those involved in the social care system know that this is the starting position of what we need to deliver. So it's not the case that, well, we can't help you anymore. Mm-hmm. We can't possibly do that. Well, you need to help people because these are their rights and what you're going to do to achieve that.
Thank
you. That was a little bit clunky, but...
No, that was helpful. And obviously accept the premise that Carers Scotland put down about not conflating rights with responsibilities. I think that's a really, really important point. Your submission also talks about a complaints system, and obviously that is key where people's rights are not being realised. What can they do about it? Do you want to talk more about the complaints side of things?
Yes, I mean, I think I agree completely that a charter is an important document. It's an important place for people to understand what their rights are. We saw that with the charter that went along with the Carers Scotland Act, and it enabled people to see what their rights were, rights to an assessment, rights to break, etc. And it was all in one place, and I think that was really helpful. But to me, what the charter and indeed across the piece is missing is around redress and around complaints. The current system doesn't work for people. I know work has been done on it, but it is complex for individuals. Sometimes they feel they're not being listened to, and the query about possible negative impacts from complaining. So we think it's important to develop a new system for complaints as part of the National Care Service, which runs alongside the Charter, which sits with the principles. If the principles of the Bill and the Charter are around human rights and advancing equality, then individuals should be able to complain and have decisions made and redress provided if it's negatively impact on their realisation of human rights, if it's had detriment to carers with one or more protected characteristics, but also on the ability to thrive and fulfil your potential. And I think if we're saying these things on the face of the Bill, if we're talking about rights in the Charter, then we need to have an effective system of redress that runs alongside it, not just a complaint that you can go to the SPSO and they might uphold your complaint, but that doesn't necessarily change things for you. So I think I believe it is something fundamental to developing accountability, because it's about accountability to the individual who use services and their carers, and for them to know that they can call someone to account as well.
Enable Scotland to have views on the charter or the complaints process at all?
I think the simple answer to the question of what we think of the charter is that we think it's great. You know, I think it is good to have these rights that people have captured. I agree that having it in a single document is helpful, and that's definitely something we support. I think what we need to see is how this would actually happen in practice. How would these rights be upheld? The experience of people with a learning disability and their families far too often has been that they have rights. They have rights under existing legislation, and those rights are not upheld. And then what happens? And I think that is a frustration. And you know, we have seen it. The Scottish Government's own health and care experience survey published in May was showing how people were not having access to their rights. I think especially around self-directed support, respondents to that survey, only 53% said that they felt they had a say in their own support. And that had been as high as 80% back in 2016. So we were getting it right for a while, and it's declined. I think likewise, people saying they were supported to live as independently as possible has gone down from 85% to only 65% feeling that. So we have those rights from legislation like the Self-Directed Support Act, and yet people are not actually getting those rights in practice. So absolutely support the Charter of Rights. I think it has captured a lot of those elements that need to be in there. There is, you know, in parallel, the incorporation of the UN Charter for the Rights of Persons with Disabilities into Scots law. I think what's critical with all of those charters, all of those pieces of legislation, is what actually happens when your rights aren't being upheld. And I think that's the gap that there is in some of the existing legislation. And I think we would be keen that there isn't such a gap for the National Care Service bill. If people have these rights and they're not getting access to those rights, what do they do to fix it? We need that to be really, really clear, and a really clear vehicle to redress that.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel so far for their contributions. I just want to turn to commissioning, tendering and procurement in the bill. Note in particular Age Scotland submission in relation to this. The belief that a market has been dominated by independent sector because not-for-profit organisations have been unable to compete to provide services. Mr Sakura, I just wonder if you could perhaps elaborate on your written submission, and in particular whether you believe ethical commissioning should be referred to and defined on the face of the bill.
Sometimes the word count on these things may be too much detail. I understand the need for the word count because you have so much coming in. The point around this has been the landscape and the fabric of our care services in Scotland over the last 10, 15, 20 years has changed dramatically. That we used to have a lot more publicly owned, publicly run, not-for-profit services as part of that mix. It's not saying that private or independent care providers are not a good thing. I'm just saying that the kind of the balance and the mix of people's options for local delivery, for specialisms, all these things have changed dramatically. Where it never goes by, a number of months won't go by without hearing stories of a local authority looking to close a care home, for instance, but not on the basis of its quality of care, but on the cost. And I think going back to sort of inception of this bill, I remember conversations with care providers from not-for-profit sector, third sector, who felt that there was almost a race to the bottom in terms of that commissioning. Who was the cheapest would get the gig. Mm. And I think at one point, I mean, I'm sure it was Royal Voluntary Service had to withdraw from parts of the country or some services years ago because they couldn't possibly deliver the care that they wanted to on the money that was available. So the challenge that folks have been facing was that actually there wasn't enough money in the system, that the bids were not viable, they weren't going to get picked because they're too low, and you had to almost create an environment that, or create a bid that was going to be the cheapest thing, and that wasn't going to have the best care outcomes. I think ethical commissioning is vital in this. There'll be experts in how that really works, to be honest, that'll be better placed to give you that insight. But I think the thing that we've lost is that really good mix of care provision. Mm. And for instance, look at rural Scotland. I think is, you know, big challenge. Private care home, I don't mean that in a negative sense, but in the Highlands is looking to close. But there won't be another care home for miles upon miles upon miles for people. Where do folks go? How do they stay connected? Moving home when you live in residential care can be life or death. And then it becomes largely the challenge for the health service to kind of pick up, and quality of life will be poor. So I think this is about making sure there is having better means of commissioning, having more kind of, I suppose it's money in the system, having more options will have a much better care service, many more options. And I think this goes back one point, but Fiona's piece about complaints, that people as well might not complain about the care receiving because there are no other options. If this care home, for instance, was to evict me for no longer being able to meet my needs, then there's nowhere else for me to go. If the council have not given me any other options in terms of who can deliver that home help equivalent piece, then I will not get any care at all. So I think that's why it's crucially important. So thanks for the question. Hope that answered to some degree.
Yeah, it's just also to ask, really, do you feel that the bills, the proposed amendments from the government would improve a level playing field? Is that something you feel confident in?
I don't know if I'd say confident. I don't necessarily mean it a negative either. I'm not really sure. I think part of this, there's a lot of in the bill which is lacking in detail. Mm. And to be honest, not really knowing how things will work in practice going in the future. So I think there's opportunity, I think, at this stage in the bill for there to be a better system for this. But I couldn't answer with any degree of certainty if I'm confident in that or not.
Just to be clear, you would like to see ethical commissioning explicitly on the face of the bill?
The concept, yeah. I think, yes. But I can imagine there are people far better versed than I to work out how that might be possible or not. Sure. But I think it's something that's a really, really important concept for it.
Thanks very much. I just want to open up to other panellists about their views on the ethical commissioning beyond the face of the bill and, indeed, what could be done to strengthen the definition of ethical commissioning in the bill. Mr McCullough.
I think in terms of ethical commissioning, I think that is very important. And I think if the bill specifies that and, again, expands what exactly is meant by that, I think will be positive. I think we see in terms of the mixed market of social care provision in Scotland consistently, the third sector and the public sector achieve better care inspectorate grades than the private sector. Some research published by Oxford University in the last few days looking at England, where 82% of care homes are run by the private sector, but 98% of enforced closures by the Care Quality Commission are in the private sector. Mm. So I think that we do see a risk, especially where you have offshore and private equity funding coming in to snap up care homes in Scotland, which we have seen in a number of cases. We saw most starkly and frankly horrifically during the COVID pandemic that some of the worst instances were in some of those private equity-owned care homes. So I think that we do need to make sure that when we invest, because we have always supported investment, we have talked about investing in the social care workforce, we know that partners in the trade union movement sometimes have a niggle on that if we invest in the social care workforce across the sector, that will include the private sector, and there's a risk of some of that increased public investment being bled offshore as profit. That's not a reason why we don't invest in the workforce, and we do think we do need to move on that. But I think if we move towards more of an ethical commissioning structure, where if private sector provision is part of that, that we have at least got minimum standards that are expected in terms of that money staying in Scotland and the level of quality that is being delivered in that sector. But I do think that it is a potential gap. We don't want to have a situation in Scotland where ethical providers, in the third sector in particular, are being squeezed out and that we do have overwhelming private sector provision with perhaps less control in terms of quality or where that public investment is actually being spent.
Do you see the potential for market distorting behaviour from private players in the market? And that might be a reason why they're winning contracts but they're not performing well. Is that something you've seen evidence of?
I think that is certainly a risk. And I think we have seen even instances where, and again, we have a recruitment challenge in social care, but sometimes people are attracted to a private bank, a private sector bank, rather than filling immediate vacancies where perhaps the terms are better elsewhere. We have seen instances of that in years gone by. So it is certainly a risk that's there. I think that a role that we would have seen for the National Care Service would be a bit more of that proactive management of the market in Scotland, not waiting till something fails before a regulator like the Care Inspectorate is empowered to intervene. More of that, so identify warning signs in some of that provision and intervene, because as we always come back to, it's all about the experience of care for the people who are accessing these services. And wherever there is the risk of a decline in quality, where there's a risk of market distortion, a role for the National Care Service in overseeing that market and intervening to ensure that there is fairness and better quality, I think is important.
Thank you very much. Just wonder if there's any further views about strengthening these provisions in the bill.
I think in general, just to say, we would support the ethical commission and being on the face of the bill. I think there's a real opportunity here for leadership and to really be talking about what we expect in terms of investment of the public pound in terms of quality, in terms of minimum standards. But we can also think about some of the things in relation to the Scottish Business Pledge. Obviously, we've got a firm view around everybody who takes part and who benefits from public procurement should be carer positive and should be supporting their employees who are carers. But you if you think further along that around family flexible workforces, employers, if you think about the workforce in care, it's overwhelmingly female, and actually thinking about commissioning, ethical commission being part of that. We think there's a role for government in terms of looking at market sufficiency as well, and particularly in relation to a right to a break from caring and having a diverse range of options available so that we don't have the situation where your right to a break may go down the traditional route of a place in a care home, but it's about meeting the outcomes of the individual and about meeting diverse outcomes as well. Local partnerships already have short break statements that set out what they have in their area, but it doesn't set out how they're going to improve. And if we're going to deliver a right to a break, then we're actually going to need to ensure that the commissioning, whether that's national or local level, delivers the right kind of market to provide that right, a meaningful right to break for carers.
Just want to quickly...
Sorry, we've only got 5 more minutes
right, no problem.
Of this panel. Dr... Yep,
certainly.
My understanding is that the adjective ethical is not in the bill. The bill talks about commissioning. It does not talk about ethical commissioning. The thing that I wanted to bring to the committee's attention is that the most ethical commissioning you can get is the commission the collective of people to help themselves and support one another. So, for example, in Grampian, we had a self-help group supporting people with the direct payments on a day-to-day basis. The local authority went out to tender, and the company that won the tender was an accountancy firm in Manchester who offered payroll services but did not offer the one-to-one support on a daily basis that groups had. That's not ethical commissioning. I think what we do need to do is to empower the collective of people to support themselves and their fellow human beings. And that's nowhere in the discussions around ethical commissioning. There is an adage that says you cannot empower the individual without empowering the collective. Their opinions know that. And business groups know that. But we need to empower the collective of disabled people. And that is the ethical way forward.
Thank you. Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. Just to remind everyone about my register of interest as a registered NHS GP, I want to touch on something we haven't really talked about at all, and that's palliative care. And I want to stay on palliative care, not touch on to assisted dying. So let's stay on palliative care. The Scottish Government produced policy paper showing 7 outcome measures. How do you think the National Care Service will impact palliative care?
I'll have a stab at this one. I think it has the opportunity to have a positive impact. I think setting out if we set out minimum standards for support, I think there's an opportunity there to ensure that palliative care is front and centre there. So I think there's an opportunity. I know there's been discussions around and a consultation around a right to palliative care. So potentially that's an opportunity to bring that right as part of the Charter of Rights and the National Care Service. So I think there's an opportunity there to improve things as part of the National Care Service, recognising that at the moment the situation for many people is not as they would prefer and as per their wishes.
So certainly I was on a panel talking about palliative care and some of the issues that surround it. And one of the big things, the big challenges, as with most things, comes down to funding. And there is what's perceived as a lack of funding for palliative care. And people feel that there's also a huge disproportionate difference between how you receive palliative care at the end of your life, if you're from an ethnic minority or if you are from a more deprived background. And that inconsistency isn't just in one health board, it's across our country. So with no more money going in to palliative care, because that's not what the National Care Service is about, and with this huge discrepancy that we're seeing, what do you feel that the National Care Service can actually do to make a tangible difference to the people who are most disproportionately affected?
I suppose probably if we go back to the question before around ethical commissioning, and part of that is around ensuring that the services that are available in your area are of a certain quality, for starters, but also that they respond to the diversity of the population in your area as well. And I think we've recognised across the piece, and I think you'll see in our submission that for people from minority ethnic communities in particular, the availability of services, and that comes from across carer strategies and more, is not, and access to services is not the same as for the majority population. And I think the commissioning part of it is the opportunity there. It could be part of the opportunity there to try and start to address some of these deep-seated issues that particularly around and particularly around poverty that have perhaps not been able to be addressed in the past. So I think that there's some opportunities through commissioning.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I thank the witnesses for their attendance here today, and please feel free to leave the room. As this is the conclusion of our further scrutiny of the National Care Service Bill ahead of formal Stage 2 proceedings, I'd like to inform members that day 1 of those proceedings is now scheduled to take place at this committee meeting on Tuesday the 26th of November. The deadline for lodging Stage 2 amendments to the bill will be 12 noon on Wednesday the 20th of November. At our next meeting on the 29th of October, we will be taking further oral evidence on the independent review of gender identity services for children and young people from the Chief Medical Officer. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.